Hello, everyone. Welcome, welcome from whatever corner of the world you may be in. Good morning to our friends here in Arizona and folks on the West Coast, and good afternoon to those on the East Coast. And to everyone else, thank you for joining us, whatever time of evening or early morning it may be for you. I appreciate everybody taking the time out to make sure that we can spend some time together. And I'm going to quickly change slides. How did you guys do on the trivia? Pretty good? Yes, no, maybe so. thanks for taking the time to play that with us. I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. There we go. All right. Welcome, everyone, to our Global Community Solutioneering Summit. We are going to spend some time together today talking about jazz and education, and we'll talk a little bit more about that in a moment. But first, I'd like to thank our sponsors, our friends at Robots and Pencils, Microsoft, AWS, everyone at ASU Enterprise Technology, and University of Arizona. So who do we have with us today? We have 31 speakers over our virtual sessions and our in-person sessions, which are happening next week in Arizona. We have 26 sessions total, and we have 312 folks registered to join us. So thanks everyone for making the time for us. If you'd like to chat with us on social, you can find us at ShapingEDU and LinkedIn, Twitter, and on YouTube. And if you haven't already, I strongly recommend downloading the Whova app. You can run it on your desktop or you can run it on your phone. That will allow you to engage with the other folks that are attending. You can network with them, with the speakers, and there's a leaderboard in there. The more you engage with it, the more points you get, and whoever has the most points at the end of this event will get an Oculus. It's true. Get yourself an Oculus. Go ahead and download that app. Want to introduce the folks that are behind the scenes here and in front of the camera too. So Laura and Stephanie and Sigrid, just say hi. There we go. That's the team that helped put this together. And we also have with us Terrell. Terrell is our graphic facilitator, and she's going to be graphically capturing all the things that we're talking about today. So for those of you that have joined us in the past, we have I had Karina Branson with us. Karina's out on maternity leave. She just had two babies. So congrats to Karina, and we'll see her again soon. Terrell is filling her big shoes and making amazing things happen in graphics land today. So this is the fifth anniversary of ShapingEDU. Back in 2018, Lev Gonick and Sam Becker called 130 education changemakers around the world and said, hey, come to Arizona, and we're going to surface the 10 biggest challenges facing education. And that group continued to meet about twice a year up until COVID, when we pivoted to having everyone join us online. So we now have about 4,000 folks around the world, and we come together and we make amazing things happen. So we'll chat a little bit about that in a sec. And what better time than our fifth anniversary to become part of the Learning Planet Alliance. Those are our friends in all over the world, and this is powered by Learning Planet Institute and UNESCO. And we'll hear from Leonora in a moment, and she'll talk about what's happening over there at Learning Planet. So we have a few expectations for the folks attending. We just ask that you be respectful, be empathetic, and be free. We are all friends here. We're trying to solve challenges together. And in order to have that spirit of collaboration, we need to keep things appropriate and positive. So please, please play by the rules. Most importantly, have fun. We're here to make amazing things happen, but to also enjoy each other's company and meet amazing people. So we ask that you do connect with other folks around the world using the Whova app. Come to our LinkedIn page. You can meet folks there too. And we ask that you embrace the spirit in which we joined. So what do we stand for at ShapingEDU? Our six C's are culture, community cultivation, collaboration, and crowdsourcing. Content is something that we output together when we're solving our challenges and addressing our challenges. So we do sit within the ASU ecosystem. For those of you that aren't familiar with ASU, it is ranked number one in the US and top five in world global impact. And we are part of the arm of ASU that is about engaging globally. So we engage with people and issues locally, nationally, and internationally. We embrace open innovation. What is that? So we like to involve many perspectives, as diverse perspectives as possible, institutions all over the world and organizations all over the world to help drive innovation. This collaboration mindset is really the foundation upon which ShapingEDU is built. So who's at the table? Who do we have joining us? We have folks from the ASU community. It's a big community. We've got about 18,000 folks that work at ASU and 140,000 students. We have global education leaders. We have subject matter experts. We have change makers from around the world. And we all work together on projects and initiatives to address the challenges that we surface. And what we do here, we have four pillars of the program. We have an online community platform that will launch on March 1st. We're very excited to share that with you and stay tuned for details there. We're also launching a living annual report, and that will be based on the ShapingEDU website and all of the content that we generate, the reports that we do, all of the toolkits that we make, everything that we produce to help our community, help their own communities of practice, those that will live in the Living Annual Report. We have community experiences like this one, and we engage in a lot of global storytelling. So we like to share each other's stories and learn from each other as much as possible. So we have five calls to action, and that really fuels everything that we do. So these are our 2023 calls to action. We're looking at AI for impactful teaching and learning, how we approach learning spaces and environments differently through digital transformation. Also, playful learning, playful pedagogy. This is becoming more and more important, and we'll talk a bit about that throughout this event. And how we democratize and decentralize education paths. Robert from Microcredential Multiverse is joining us a little bit later to chat about that. And we're also looking at holistic wellness of learners and educators. So tech for good, how do we embrace and promote tech for good? So solutioneering is why we're here. We are going to look at four ways in which we approach solutioneering. So we combine our global community and the philosophy of continuous improvement. And then we take futures thinking and design thinking, combine them all. And that is how we solutioneer. So we'll talk about that a little bit more at the end when we do some brainstorming together. So this is how we approach projects. We have first this event in which we explore what's on the horizon and what the current challenges are. And then we kick off our project cycle in March. So from March through the end of October, we do 4 to 8 week sprints, and we welcome everyone to join us, find the project you're most passionate about, and come play in the virtual sandbox with us. So what are we doing here today? We are exploring new technology and what's on the horizon for education. We're observing what's working and what's not. We are discovering projects that are in our partner network. So that's something we'll spend time together today doing is looking at what projects already exist out there. So our friends at LearningPlanet have LearningPlanet Alliance Circles. We have our friends at Learning Futures Collaborative, and that is actually within the Mary Lou Fulton Teachers College at ASU. They have five projects going on. So we'll take a look at what projects are existing and figure out where we can supplement what they're doing or come up with brand new projects if we feel like something that we need to address isn't being addressed right now. So I ask you throughout this event today to think about problems and challenges that you hear through the lens of how might we. So as you're listening to folks, I would ask that you jot down the question that would reframe this problem, this challenge, by looking at it as an opportunity. So if there is an issue that arises, let's think about it from a how might we help people do X, Y, Z. So please be be jotting things down as we're chatting today, because that'll come into play in our breakout sessions towards the end of this. So we'll look at the how might we questions we create, and then we'll look at the existing projects that we're talking about during this event. We'll look at our five calls to action, everything that we're hearing from today's speakers and your expertise. So we blend all that together and we think about how we can best spend our energy and our time and our expertise to address the challenges that we're talking about. So what are we going to do today? We're going to hear from several folks, starting with Leonora from LearningPlanet in Paris. Then we have Ken from joining us from Chicago talking about literacy equity. We'll take a quick break so everyone can refill their coffee mugs. And we will also talk about, after our break, the brighter side of AI. We'll hear from our friends at Microsoft. Then we're going to talk about how we're going to address our projects, what the projects that we're going to create, what are we going to do. We'll hear from Clarin from Learning Futures Collaboratives. And we'll also hear from our friends at Digital Promise about playful learning. And then we'll hear from Robert from Microcredential Universe about democratizing and decentralizing education. Then we'll have our breakout sessions, and then we'll come back and do share outs and figure out where there's overlap between areas of interest and opportunities. So we're going to kick things off today with our friend Leonora, and I would ask that all of the speakers, as they come into their presentations for our visually impaired friends, describe what they look like as well as what their background is, so we can all be starting on the same page on a level playing field. So I'm Stephanie Perotti. I am in my home office today, and my background is our Global Community Solutioneering Summit. Very colorful, different graphics representing the diversity in our community. I am of Western European descent. I have brown hair that is quickly graying as the days go by, and I'm wearing a gray sweater. So with that, I will introduce Leonora to introduce herself.
Thank you, Stephanie. I'm Leonora. I'm really delighted to be here. So I am based in Paris. My background, my video is now spotlighted so you can see me. My background is both fake and real. It is the office that we work from in Paris, but it's been created into a background, so it's kind of blurry and you can't really see what it looks like. So it looks like I'm in my office with a blurred background, but I'm actually sitting at home in Paris. And the border is the colors we use, the Learning Planet Festival, which are kind of a turquoise, yellow, light green, red, and yellow. I'm English. I look Caucasian. I'd like to say I have blonde hair, but I don't think it is blonde anymore, unfortunately. It's more like a dirty brown. And I'm wearing a black top. It's lovely to be here with all of you. As Stephanie said, I'm Leonora Dowley. I work on partnerships with the Learning Planet Alliance, and I am joined by the director of the Learning Planet Alliance, Olivier Préchard, who is also on this call. And I would like to tell you a little bit about the Alliance and also the festival we've just had, but I'd like to tell it a little bit like a story, because it doesn't come from nowhere. And as Stephanie said, it's powered by the Learning Planet Institute and UNESCO. I will probably talk for 10 minutes or so, so there'll be loads of time for questions. And I know that Olivier, hopefully, will put in links into the chat so you can see what I'm talking about, and you can join us if you like. So there'll be a little call to action as well, which is do join us if you can. So I will start with the story, and I would like to talk also a little bit about how we feel about things and why we started the Alliance, and that's where the new narratives and education aspect comes in. So please do put questions in the chat, and I'm really pleased to be here. And I'm also super pleased that ShapingEDU has joined the Alliance, and we have some plans together, which I will mention at the end of what I'm going to say. So in 2006, so not that long ago, but still quite a long time ago, there were two researchers in France, François Teddy and Ariel Lindner, and they saw that there were multiple crises in the world. And so they launched something that was called the Centre de Recherche Interdisciplinaire, or the Centre for Interdisciplinary Research, or the CRI. And the idea was to train the next generation of scientists who were sort of working at this crossroads between life sciences, education, and digital technologies, because they were convinced that it was necessary and also possible to adopt a new approach to education through research. So that was the genesis, and the CREE, as it was called then, doubled in size every 18 months. So it started as a small scale organization, a few desks, a lab, became this internationally renowned institute, and is now a global community with hundreds of partners across the world, or several hundred partners, lots and lots, probably uncountable. At the end of 2021, so a few years later, the Institute wanted to increase its impact and to respond to requests from the public and private sector, and it transformed into what it is now, the Learning Planet Institute. So the idea behind the Learning Planet Institute is to respond to the ambition to co-create with lots of people around the world a learning society that's capable of tackling all of the complex challenges that we face today and the ones that we're going to face in the future that we don't know yet. Since its inception, though, it has been dedicated to reinventing learning for everybody, lifelong learning, through collective intelligence, to try and build sustainable and inclusive learning societies that are able to rise to these complex challenges that I'm sure you can think of. You know, you can probably think of 10 without even really thinking about it. What we try and do at the Institute is to explore, to research, to share new ways of learning, and also to share new ways of cooperating. And I hope you're seeing why ShapingEDU and Learning Planet Alliance are interested in working together, because I think we have really similar missions. What we're trying to do is to encourage and to disseminate a culture, different methods, different tools, to transform educations to become transform organizations to become learning organizations. And ultimately, what we're doing is leading communities to try and become what we call learning planetisms. So people and things, anything that exists on the planet, supporting them to learn to take care of themselves, others, and the planet. So the crux of all that is large-scale collaboration. We want to co-build, we want to address these challenges together. And to achieve all of these goals, what we try and promote and what we're trying to do through a lot of the work at the Institute, including the Alliance, is we try and promote very far-reaching collaborations. So we want to build a learning planet. We want to develop new ways of learning and cooperating. We try and encourage the development of communities working together to find sustainable solutions in education. And also, we're trying to encourage the development of communities who are working to find ways to reach the sustainable development goals. So education and lifelong learning is a focus, but the sustainable development goals are a big part of what we look at. In 2019, the Learning Planet Institute with UNESCO created this international alliance, which is called the Learning Planet Alliance. And that's the part that I work for, and that's the part that Olivier is the director of. And the Alliance is kind of the international part of the Institute. The Institute is based in France. It's very international anyway. It has researchers from all over the place. It has students from all over the place. It has people running projects that are reach out to lots of different places. But the Alliance is really the anchor of this global community of practice that's dedicated to the transformation of education and the co-construction of the learning society, what we call the learning society. And what we do throughout the year is lead a network of multiple actors all over the world. And we have this highlight every year organized on and around the International Day of Education, which is the 24th of January, called the Learning Planet Festival. And you can see in the chat, Olivier's put all of the links so you can go and have a look at what happened at the festival this year. And I'm sure he can add some information after I've spoken. But the Alliance, it brings together really diverse, really complementary, sometimes very, very diverse actors. So NGOs, public sector actors, cities, territories, schools, universities, social entrepreneurs, private enterprises, students, young people, activists, artists. I mean, there are a lot. And they all have something in common, which is they want to, as I said before, learn and commit to taking care of themselves, others, and the planet. And they come together, they share their knowledge, they share their practices, they share their experiences. So things like creating new ways of learning, teaching, researching, mobilizing collective intelligence, in order to prepare individuals and organizations to understand A, the challenges of our time, and also face them. So everything's really aligned, and the Alliance has been working on that since 2019. Just in terms of the new narratives, I wanted to give you some background to our thinking in creating the Alliance. I think what I will say, I hope, will ring true with you, and you will recognize some of what I'm saying. I think it's no overstatement to say that we're sort of in an age of disruption and hyperchange that's characterized by loads of challenges. We have to address all sorts of things like the climate crisis, eco-anxiety, pandemics, mental health, rising inequality, mass population migrations, threats to democracy, fact, truth, fake news, all of these kind of things. And this sort of this era that we're in is also defined by a call for alternative visions of success. So what might have been termed success in the past is not necessarily what we want to define success as now and for the future. And this comes from new perspectives and metrics that have emerged from disciplines like philosophy, social science, economics, and also standpoints that are sort of outside the traditional academics, so social entrepreneurs, businesses, young people, activists. And all of those voices are joined by people leading in education, so teachers, parents, students. And there's really, I think, we're feeling this call for a revolution about, you know, what it means to be successful in the world. We think that knowledge and learning are kind of the basis for resilience and transformation. And we think that there's an urgent need for new ways of learning, new ways of teaching, new ways of doing research, new ways of mobilizing collective intelligence so that we can rise to these challenges. So what we're not alone in thinking that. For example, the UN General Assembly decided not that long ago that they would create an International Day of Education, 24th of January. UNESCO published something called the Futures of Education Report, Reimagining Our Futures Together. These things kind of identify the need for a worldwide collaborative agenda and an agenda where everybody is invited to contribute. That's the really important thing. In order to affect real world change in communities, countries, and regions. So not just top down, you know, sideways, up, down, round and round, people really collaborating together. We think that the path to this future is new narratives to recreate the purpose of learning. We think that we need really bold, really inspiring alternatives in order to evolve kind of the range, diversity, personalization of learning opportunities. We think that we should be harnessing the collective intelligence of learning ecosystems. And we think that we should be creating a framework for social renaissance based on various values, but sustainability, solidarity, responsibility, among other things. We know that this requires political will. It requires the will of stakeholders. It requires public will. And it also really requires young people to be included right through, really included, really listened to. So what we like to say is, you know, moving forward, education needs to be everybody's business. It's no longer something that just happens and then other people kind of go along with it. So the LearningPlanet Alliance ecosystem, which is now hundreds of partners around the world, we had 600 plus partners involved in our festival that just happened at the end of January. All of these partners are actively contributing to the creation of these new narratives. And that's why ShapingEDU is such an exciting partner for us as well, with your network and all of the projects and the ideas that you have. And what we have done, the Alliance and its partners, has sort of established itself as a middle ground for diverse stakeholders. So anything from government organizations to grassroots actors and everything in between. The idea is to have an ecosystem that has kind of really extensive and deep engagement between lots and lots of partners. And as I said, once a year, we have this huge highlight. It's the LearningPlanet Festival in partnership with UNESCO and all of the pioneering organizations that are part of the Alliance, as well as thousands of students and young activists from all around the world. And hopefully you next year, if you would like to be part of it, we'd love to have you. This year was the fourth edition. We had about 60,000 participants online from 191 countries. So it really is a global movement. That was supplemented by thousands of participants taking part in lots of local events. So we had local events in Delhi and Phoenix and Paris and Dakar and Bogota. Really, it was global. And it was it was really exciting. It was full of kind of meaningful engagement, people meeting each other, people collaborating, people communicating, and it was full of kind of joy and hope. And that's what we try and do. We try and celebrate what people are really doing, because it can be quite depressing sometimes to think about the huge transformations that need to happen. So as a result, the festival's kind of been shaping new narratives around learning in the 21st century, celebrated on the ground initiatives, and we shared experiences and ideas, as well as examples of scaled successful experiments, so that we can spread learnings and dream beyond the boundaries that we think exist. We also use it as a moment to encourage people, especially young people, to become game changers and code breakers, and to inspire them to become planetizens. We like to say Esinu, which kind of translates as "and if we could," so very similar to what Stephanie was talking about earlier, and we're really aligned with that. And just as I finish, I'd like to talk about the circles that Stephanie mentioned. So one of the really notable things that happens every year during the festival is the concrete creation of new collaborations, often in the form of new projects or what we call circles. And this is where you can come in, and I think this is where ShapingEDU and LearningPlanet Alliance will be partnering a little bit more firmly over the course of this year, I hope. So a circle is something that we create with core partners, so people who come to us and organizations who come to us and say that they'd like to do this with us. And it brings together organizations, a circle brings together organizations who are committed to the same thematic priorities. They are dedicated spaces, online, but can be offline as well, which advance the dialogue among a diverse set of stakeholders, but along one priority. So we've got at the moment the Youth Empowerment Circle, which is co-led alongside LearningPlanet Alliance with CAP 2030 and Catalyst 2030. So that collaborates to connect inspirational youth game changers and initiatives across health, sustainability, rights, and education. We've got a circle called Teachers of the Planet, which is co-led by the Aga Khan Foundation and Teach for All. And that is the official long-term road to COP28 for the advancement of climate action through education, specifically through teachers. And Mary Lou Fulton Teachers College is involved in that as well. We've got something called the Ubuntu Learning Circle, which is co-led by the Club of Rome. That brings together a small working group of committed actors who are active in place-based learning and sustainability initiatives in Africa, so across the African continent. We've got a circle called Transitions in Higher Education, which is led actually by UDI at ASU and Dartington Trust. And that kind of charts possible avenues for collaboration between higher education institutions in this, this journey towards new narratives. We've got a few more that are in development. We've got one about imagination, and we hope that we will have a few, depending on the outcomes, I think of this, this summit, I hope we'll have a few with ShapingEDU. So the call is, join us with these new narratives. If you'd like to find out more, all of the links that would be useful to you are in the chat. There is a join us button on the LearningPlanet Alliance page. You're welcome to click it, find out what happens, get in touch with us for a conversation. There are specific circles, if you're interested in them, that you can join already. They all have links to them. You can check out the festival website. We have written a Planetism manifesto, which you can read. We've written a little bit about our thinking behind these new narratives. I am available for questions if you like, but I'm really pleased Olivier has been able to join us as well, and he may have some things to add. So Olivier, I don't know if he's shaking his head or not, but I will pause there and hand back to Stephanie in case there are any questions or in case Olivier wants to speak. Thank you so much, everybody.
Thank you, Leonora. Olivier, you want to wave to us? There we go.
Very pleased to be with you. I think Leonora has been telling and sharing a lot of information, so I don't want to add too many things there. Happy to answer questions with her if you have any questions, or I put some links in the chat, my contact details also, because Leonora will soon be a young mother, so which is a great news. So I will be around in the coming weeks or months if you need to be in touch, with great pleasure. So thank you for having us. We are collaborating a lot with ASU in many different fields, talking with a lot with UDI, but also many other people around ASU, And we had really strong contribution this year at the festival, and it all the way through arts and education with Iveta, Sidova, and many different dimensions. So this is absolutely great. So pleased to be with you.
And maybe there's a question about K-12 early education programs, Olivier, at the Institute.
Well, yes, so since the inception, we have created programs that are outside the Institute for youth. It's very much based on youth scientist approaches. How do you make sure that young people from 3 to 18 years old can work in collaboration with each other to address complex programs, subjects that matters to them, or at the frontier of knowledge. So young people at 3, 5, 7, 8 years old will be exploring the brain of a climate throughout the year with a classroom and with scientific mentors. And this is working pretty well. It's called Saventurier. We've developed it for 9 years within LPI and trained 35,000 teachers across 10 French-speaking countries, mainly in France, but in other places too. That's one. Another one is called Bâtisseur de Possible, which is an adaptation of Design for Change that you may know. Design for Change was created by Kiran Birseti. It is also for young people, targeting a lot of the teenagers, but it works for all young people. And it's based on design thinking. The methodology is quite simple. It's called FIDS for kids. Young people as teams are invited to feel, imagine, do, and share throughout the year. So we do a lot of real world projects, and we do spread the Bâtisseur de Possible version in France and French speaking countries. So these are kind of programs we do for kids. We have insertion programs for dropouts or adults. We have quite a lot of things. The students at the LPI, to give you an idea, come from 60 different countries, average, very few compared to ASU, but a big diversity. And maybe one last thing on training, which I think is very important, is that we are working very hard on transforming a lot of our master degrees and PhD and bachelor degrees to bring together the university and social impact and social entrepreneurs. We meet hundreds of young people when they are 12 or 14 who create NGOs, who are engaged with many subjects, climate, equity, women's rights, and things like this. But when they enter higher education, it's quite difficult to have these expertise, this engagement recognized by the university. And we feel that we need to design, and we've started a bachelor degree called Bachelor's Act, that really select young people based on their engagement and understand what they have learned from being engaged young citizens. And we create we create new programs of education that really bring the university and the impact dimension much stronger together. And we also work with UDI, with universities like HSE, UDI, Arizona State, Glasgow University, others that have a strong impact. And we also work with learning ecosystems, and I think these are connected. Learning ecosystems in the Global South, universities at the heart of these ecosystems, students who became game changers. These are very strong motivation of what we do on an everyday basis.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Olivier. I know we've got a couple more questions in chat, and we'll forward those to you and connect you with the folks asking the questions so you can speak with them directly. And thank you so much, both of you, for joining us. I know it's a little late in the day for you guys, but we appreciate it. So thank you so much. And we'll also share with you this amazing graphic that has been created and we're looking at right now. And we'll also post that on our website. So know that those are coming. All right, let's shift gears a little bit. And, oops, ta-da, okay. So now we're gonna meet Ken Bigger, who is a senior fellow at the American Library Association Center for the Future of Libraries. And we're gonna talk about literacy equity. So Ken, if you could introduce yourself and describe yourself and your surroundings for our visually impaired friends, that would be fantastic.
Thanks, Stephanie. It is a pleasure to be here. Thanks for the invitation. My name is Ken Bigger. My pronouns are he, him, his. I'm in the graying zone of strawberry blonde or light red hair and beard. and glasses. I am wearing a blue shirt and a red cardigan sweater. And because for reasons beyond my ken, no pun intended, I can't enable backgrounds on Zoom. My background is sort of a plain off-white wall and a little bit of a white door. So sorry that it's not more visually interesting. I am going to share screen, which might, I hope, be a little bit more visually interesting. So I'm going to do that now and begin my chat. Well, just a moment, please. Here we go. And is everybody seeing now the slideshow presentation? There we go. So today I want to talk about the shape of literacy equity, civic fluency, libraries, and new directions for literacy work. As a bit of a background for myself, I have a PhD in religious ethics and political theory from the Divinity School at the University of Chicago. For 4 years prior to January 2022, I served as the executive director of the Chicago Literacy Alliance. And I'm going to talk a little bit about that, but the things that are most particularly relevant is that we developed a theory of change there that we call the Equity Through Literacy Framework. And with that framework, a theory of change, we designed some tools to boost literacy equity in our community, including the Literacy Equity Initiative Insights Dashboard. I'm going to talk a little bit about that as well. As Stephanie mentioned, I am currently a joint senior fellow at the American Library Association Center for the Future of Libraries, and I also work with the Barbara Bush Foundation for Family Literacy. I work with them on a variety of technology-based solutions, particularly around issues of edtech approaches for adult literacy. Sorry, I got a little gummed up there. But a big part of my job really is around research, writing, and advocacy with regards to advancing literacy equity. And so I'm going to talk about that. So again, part of my context is that I was the executive director of the Chicago Literacy Alliance, which is an organization that unfortunately did not survive the financial consequences of the pandemic. I know that is all too common a story. But when it was in existence, the CLA was a coalition of over 100 literacy-focused organizations working with all ages and all communities, covering everything from learning to read and write to loving to read and write. And the CLA was not a direct service organization, so did not actively engage in tutoring or teaching with regard to literacies development, but rather supported organizations that did that. We had a vision of a 100% literate Chicago, and we sought to improve literacy in Chicago by driving collaboration, increasing the impact of our community's literacy organizations. We did this primarily through capacity building, alignment, and advocacy. Why do I say literacy equity? I want to distinguish literacy equity from speaking specifically about literacies. By literacies, generally speaking, if I were talking about literacy, I'd be talking about focusing on tools or strategies or methods of instruction for adults or children. Very broadly speaking, I think of literacies as systems of knowledge and power mediated by or using cultural tools and symbols. I do this for a number of different reasons, but one is to be future focused, and the other is to be conscious that there are multiple literacies that ultimately make up the kind of goal that organizations in this field seek to foster. So by literacy equity, rather, I mean doing a systemic analysis of the social distribution of educational access or access to educational opportunity. And in this, I'm focusing a lot more on opportunity access as drivers of achievement than particular teaching strategies or that sort of thing. So that is the virtue of the distinction. The work that I do takes, I keep recurring to this quote from Stephen Jay Gould, which I'm going to share with you as a way of kind of informing my approach to this topic. And it's this quote from a book called The Panda's Thumb, where he says that I am somehow less interested in the weight and convolution of Einstein's brain than in the near certainty that people of equal talent have lived and died in cotton fields and sweatshops. This, to me, in part, unfolds the opportunity that's before us with regard to literacy equity and that there is a tremendous amount of genius to be unleashed. And so I ask the question, in pursuing greater literacy equity, how is it that we go about better normalizing or assuming, genius in the work that we're doing? The framework for what I'm really trying to accomplish in my research, writing, and advocacy agenda is getting us to think in better and new ways. In doing this work, I'm taking part of my inspiration from my friend Hal J. Malum Jr.'s Innovation Dynamics, which starts with a procedure that invites one to think about what are the norms, hidden or otherwise, that are entrenching a given social situation, challenge, or problem. And so I specifically ask, you know, what are the hidden norms or not so hidden norms that are entrenching literacy inequity? And I'm just going to focus on two today. I actually have a list of about a dozen, frankly, but I'm going to focus on two for the sake of time. And the first one is that I think sometimes we're focusing, or quite often we're focusing on the wrong thing. We are misdefining the challenge. And so I'm going to also adapt Art Markham's headline here from the Harvard Business Review. You know, how you define the problem or challenge or opportunity determines whether or not you solve it or make an advance. So I'm going to talk first about that, about misdefining the challenge. And then secondly, I'm going to talk about inefficiencies in the nonprofit and public sector, that the supports that those institutions, and kind of including libraries, offer. So, and try to paint a way towards a way of doing that more effectively, more efficiently, with greater collaboration and cooperation. In that respect, carrying on the legacy of the mission of the Chicago Literacy Alliance in other ways. So, moving to the first norm, focusing on the wrong goal in literacy equity. And I think one of the ways that we do this is quite understandable, that we define the challenge as solving low literacy rather than instead fostering civic fluency. I'm going to tell you a little bit more about what I mean by civic fluency in just a moment, but the things that I think represent problems within this idea of focusing on the wrong goal are that quite often what solving low literacy does causes an overemphasis on achievement strategies and an underemphasis on how is it that we empower greater access and that we advocate for the sector to be more efficiently supported. Also, this focus on solving low literacy focuses a lot more on the tools than on what the tools enable. You know, what is the fundamental situation of political, social, educational equality or equity that we want to foster rather than focusing on a specific set of tools. And by that specific set of tools, I think quite often what we wind up doing in discussions about literacy and literacy equity is often importing an uncritical or monolithic notion about what literacy or literacies represent. And that can create an issue of asking very good questions of, you know, how were those definitions developed and who was at the table when those, and who wasn't at the table when those definitions were developed. So by focusing on civic fluency, I want to be orienting us towards thinking about what future we want to inhabit together and making the constitution of the literacies that make that up a more explicit focus of our conversation. Also, focusing on low literacy is something that I think tends to admire us in deficit discourse, that is defining a problem or a challenge by what some group of people are seen to lack. And I think it's a huge issue within our field because fundamentally, nobody really likes to be defined by what others see them as lacking. And so what we really wanna be doing is pivoting out of that mode and using a more asset-based approach. And then finally, there is, I think, it, within this tendency of solving low literacy, a tendency to kind of focus on an anemic or unhelpful sort of appeal to rights. You know, and we have this at the CLA too. We had sweatshirts that said literacy is a human right. And I think that's true, but it's not, unfortunately not true enough. And bringing that out as a statement is often something that is meant to kind of end a conversation and not begin one. And I think that in this area of literacy equity, we need to be constantly focused on fostering an inclusive and equitable and diverse dialogue. And just as a quick point, an illustration of about focusing on the wrong goal. My image here was inspired by my friend Mary, who learned to ride a bike as an adult. She said the best piece of advice that she ever got about how to ride a bike is to focus on where you want to go, not on what you're afraid of hitting. So my focus here in this work is as much as possible to try to focus on where it is that we want to go. And where I believe we want to go with literacy equity work is a goal of civic fluency. And by that, I mean an individual's ability to navigate the multiple spheres of a full human adult life in community with competence. And this includes you know, civic participation, workplace participation, participation in the arts and culture, the ability to navigate the healthcare environment, you know, really adopting an inclusive view of this. a friend of mine, a colleague at the Center for the Future of Libraries for the ALA, he termed this adulting for the revolution. And I don't necessarily disagree, but the concept is that the goal of literacy equity work is to be fostering that sort of goal. And in that sense, also very future focused. So again, I think in this work, it's my inclination and what I want to advocate for that we need to be guided more by the good we seek or the goal we seek than by the wrong that we're trying to rectify. That is, we're going to define injustice by relative to a conversation and vision of a view of justice rather than the reverse. Part of this was inspired, you know, very early on when I didn't have very good or sophisticated or appropriate language around literacy, but I had started leading the CLA as an organization and I was giving a presentation. And somebody asked me, what do you mean by literacy? And I realized at that time that I didn't really have a much better definition than not illiteracy. And I don't use the term illiteracy for a variety of reasons, which I can go into offline anymore. I don't use that term anymore. But this question really sort of said, okay, yeah, we need to get busy thinking about what it is that we're trying to create, not just what we're trying to undo. And helpfully, this gentleman, and I don't have his name, I need to go back and look it up, but he was a big part of the inspiration for the civic fluency model for me, came up with the back of the envelope kind of list of the various competencies and tools that could be part of civic fluency. So an analogy that might be helpful about how this kind of reorientation of thinking with regard to literacy equity might be helpful would be to kind of deploy, you know, the concept of a more perfect union, which is a line from the Constitution, of course, but also one invoked, you know, recently by our President Obama in talking about how is it that we kind of build this common project of democratic community together. Similarly, Martin Luther King, within the context of the civil rights movement, used the context of the beloved community. You know, while it's called the civil rights movement, and a big part of it was about the rectification of injustice and the seeking to put everybody on a footing of equality, the vision that animated King was not just about kind of balancing scales. It was about an affirmative vision of what is the society that we want to be inhabiting and how is it that we get there. So if it helps, and if it's not too presumptuous, I could say that, you know, the analogy for civic fluency is that it is a kind of beloved community of literacy. What is it that we want that to look like? So just to be wrap up the civic fluency portion and what I think it represents a reflection that literacies are continuous. They're not binaries. You know, this is a kind of implicit. We are all on continuums of literacies. And so in that respect, we need to be operating out of a sense of solidarity and not saviorism in the work that we're doing. This is one of the ways that the vision of civic fluency, I think, helps animate greater progress. Some of you may be familiar with a line from a community of Aboriginal activists in Australia who said, you know, if you're here to help me, you're wasting your time. But if you're here because your liberation is bound up with mine, then let's work together. And this is one of the things that really, I think, is part of what civic fluency hopes to introduce to the literacy equity conversation, which although it's future focused, it's one that really begins to bring the means and ends in line. That if we are trying to envision the future in which everybody has a voice, we need to start participating in practices that embody that kind of inclusion and that working with and not for. And then finally, it is a vision, you know, again, it's all very abstract. I'm going to point to some practical implications in a moment, that abstraction, that level of kind of indefinability, that level that we can kind of approach it but never get there is actually, I think, an asset and not a strength. You know, that it is a goal that we approach sort of asymptotically and is one that can open and embrace multiple literacies as our, you know, we evolve together as a community. I like to point out that if you envision that the human species appeared on the planet about 24 hours ago. We've only been reading and writing for the last half hour or so. And so for a long time, whatever literacies represented, they did not involve reading and writing, but they involved other systems of knowledge and power by which people mediated their social relations. So, okay, I've been told in part that I have a philosopher's penchant for abstraction. So where does the rubber meet the road on this? And so I just want to give you one quick example of how we put this into practice at the CLA. And this was through the Literacy Equity Insights Dashboard, where we created a asset-based, access-focused diagnostic tool to assess the levels of literacy access within a community. Again, framing this about what are the socioeconomic conditions that structure access to literacy for these communities, rather than what are the achievement levels in this community. So this is something that wound up driving a focus that not only helped us animate and plan out our practices, but also helped drive a conversation about, you know, the broader systems. And importantly, what this did, as we began to identify communities that were facing the broader challenges of barriers to access to literacy, is that we adopted a catalytic leadership model, that is working with, not for, taking the expertise and the goal setting of the communities with which we and our members sought to work, and taking our direction from them rather than viewing ourselves as delivering a service to them. So that is the first norm. The second norm, which I think touches a little bit more on my current day job on the ALA, is nonprofit sector inefficiencies. This is, I think, something that does stand in the way of greater literacy equity. And by this, you know, I think one of the dimensions of this is that literacy equity is an ecosystem level challenge. And a lot of the nonprofit ecosystem is set up to kind of provide or incentivize organizations to kind of claim that they're the silver bullet, that they are the solution. And on the contrary, I think to say that you could solve a literacy equity situation with any one particular solution is sort of akin to trying to say that you could solve global warming by just recycling a lot more. It's really not realistic. You know, and one indicator of this is that the single biggest indicator of a child's educational prospects is parental literacy. And I can go into the details of that offline, but what it points to is that we tend to invest a lot in particular kinds of strategies with particular kinds of communities, but the solution is really only going to be found when everybody is working together more effectively. And the problem that we have with the ethos of scarcity and the tendency of marketing language and nonprofit appeals is that there can be a tendency to silver bullet thinking. And there can also be a problem within the sector that organizations are, you know, a lot of the voluntary sector that is set up to tackle this challenge is built on an ecosystem that sort of assumes that whoever's doing it and being paid to do it is not the first income in their family, that they are a second income of their family. And this has some practical consequences in terms of the ability to hire equitably. For instance, it can be really hard for organizations to hire people who have student loans to pay back. And particularly within the literacy equity sector, this can present some challenges in bridging, you know, some pretty important cultural divides. So want to attend to that. So, you know, to resolve this or to address this, I want to kind of focus on or propose, you know, kind of a distinction here between two kinds of institutions. And there may be more, but like just in terms of like broader types. On the one side are enduring and evolving institutions like libraries, schools, universities, arts organizations, things that really propose to be part of our civil society and gateways for people into civic and community participation for the long haul. In contrast to those, I think we have organizations that I call problem-focused institutions, which are ones that arise to address a particular injustice or a gap. And another word for that is a situation that shouldn't exist. And so what I think that what we need to be able to do is come up with a way to allow problem-focused institutions, which because of the environment of the nonprofit ecosystem are often forced into situations where they say, we're here to address a problem that shouldn't exist and we will always be here. There's a little bit of a cognitive dissonance in that message, right? That ultimately they should be orienting their programs and services with, you know, and again, not a facile goal, but a realistic and an intentional goal of putting themselves out of business. What is it that they need to do to be solving the problem? So in response to this particular norm, I want to ask a couple what ifs and what might we do? And so those questions are, what if we created better systems, optimizing enduring and evolving institutions and problem-focused institutions in partnership with one another? What if we could more effectively leverage the way that libraries, our schools, provided real or virtual infrastructure for the delivery of a variety of different kinds of literacy supporting services, providing greater opportunity for impact and flexibility, reducing the infrastructure costs of those organizations and improving coordination. So this is, I think, an area where libraries, from within the perspective of my current work, have a role that they can play. They are trusted institutions. As much as there is a current debate over book banning and that sort of thing, it is indicative in part of the power that libraries have and are known to have. So, in sum, you know, I think what I'm trying to focus on and advocate for is a pivot of thinking here that imagines a world preferable to the predictable one. building greater literacy equity through a focus on civic fluency, a dedicated practice of catalytic leadership of working with communities that are facing challenges to access, and that we can do more creative imagining with regard to improving access, efficiency, and coordination across the institutions that are addressing this challenge. Thanks, that's me. Please feel free to reach out to me via email or on LinkedIn. Love to continue the conversation, love to socialize and improve these ideas. And I have not been able to attend to the chat because I find it super difficult to do that and present, but I'm happy to respond to any questions that people have.
Thank you so much, Ken. We've got a poll that we posted about who do we think is doing great job with civic fluency in libraries, and we've got some great answers. So feel free to add your thoughts to the chat there as well. And we are going to take a quick 5-minute break, come back at the top of the hour, and we'll hear from our friends at Microsoft. So with that in mind, we are going to listen to a little jazz, take a 5-minute break. Feel free to refill your coffee and tend to your needs, and then we'll be right back. Okay, welcome back, everyone. We are going to get rolling again. Here we go. Okay. Okay, thanks again to our sponsors, Robots and Pencils, Microsoft, AWS, ASU Enterprise Technology, and the University of Arizona. So with that, let's kick it over to our friends at Microsoft to talk about the brighter side of AI, how tech can help us to address student mental health equity and diversity. So welcome, everyone. If you could please introduce yourself and how you appear and what your background is for our visually impaired friends, that would be fantastic. We'll kick it off with Jennifer.
All right. Can everyone see me? Can you see me okay, Steph?
Yes.
Perfect. I'm very, very excited today to be joined by my colleagues. We're all on the industry team here at Microsoft. This is a topic that we're all very, very passionate about, especially when it comes to student success. And I know AI is a very hot topic right now, and we really want to talk about what are the positives about it. You know, I think there's a lot of negative energy around it right now. We just want to bring a little bit of positivity into the world right now and talk about how we can better students' lives. I'll pass it off to Melissa.
Hi, everybody. My name is Melissa Hortman. I am on the industry team with Krystin and Jennifer at Microsoft. Really excited to be here today. I have a long history in higher education, so I'm very passionate about this topic from the faculty perspective and how does this really kind of come into the classroom and how do we use it in our research and just kind of understand it. I'm a Caucasian woman with blonde hair down to my shoulders, glasses with a black rim, a Microsoft teal shirt on representing today with a background of some geometric shapes and some wreaths. I will pass it over to Krystin.
Hello, I am Krystin Watkins. I'm also very excited to be a part of this event today and to present. I am a part of the industry team along with Melissa and Jennifer. I have a little over 7 years of experience in higher education as a faculty member, a committee chair, an academic coach. I'm very passionate about work in this space and diversity and inclusion. I am a Black female with brown and Black hair. I have on a Black shirt with a white collar, and I have a white background behind me. And I will pass it back to Jennifer.
Awesome. Let me get this view ready to go for us real quick. Okay, awesome. Krystin, Melissa, can you guys thumbs up if you see this for me? Perfect. So we already introduced ourselves. I also like to make sure that before we start, we always share a little bit of tidbits about ourselves. So this is a little bit of ourselves, who we are inside and outside of work, and what we do as industry executives. I really, really want to focus on the strategy side of the student success. I am a huge Bay Area sports fan. I'm actually born and raised from California, but I currently live in New York. I'm a big music enthusiast, and I like to say I'm a self-proclaimed food critic here because I am constantly going to different areas of New York, trying new restaurants, writing a lot of Yelp reviews. So if anyone has any tips that you guys want when you visit New York, let me know. I'll pass it to Melissa again real quick to talk about herself.
So I am a mother of two crazy kids, if that tells you anything about my life. It is all centered around them and all the amazing things that we get to do. But I like to kind of focus in on myself and spend some time with myself. So I'm a long distance runner for that reason. It makes me disconnect from work. You know, it makes me truly kind of connect with myself, who I am, and just be grounded as I move forward. I live in Charleston, South Carolina, so I always have sand everywhere in my house and always in all of my socks. And I will say that I'm forever young. Even as I age, I'd like to stay forever young. I'll pass it over to Krystin.
So I am a wife and a new mom. Infant, she's not quite at the crazy stage yet, but I'm looking forward to that, Melissa. I'm based in Atlanta. I love fishing. I haven't been able to do it as much with my little one, but I'm excited about getting her exposed. I love hot tea, and I'm very active in the community in Atlanta. So that's a little about me.
Awesome. So let's sort of get into the meat of why we're here today. A big part of our job here at Microsoft is we do a lot of research and understanding of what people are saying. And a big part of that too is what are the students saying? And I don't think we do enough of amplifying the student voices. So there's a lot of research out there and a lot of surveys that have been done where there's data that shows that how students persist towards graduation is directly correlated with their sense of belonging. And when you keep looking, a lot of the research also says that marginalized students have characteristically different experiences of engagement and success than majority of their peers. And then on top of that, let's really consider also this COVID generation of kids, where a lot of us don't even have an understanding of it because a lot of us have gone through school past the COVID times. And so we don't know what they're going through. And it reportedly shows that 60% of college students report a lot of increased anxiety during the pandemic. And I really want to highlight these points because when you look at the first point about how it's correlated with their sense of belonging, but then they also have this increased anxiety because of the pandemic, there's this gap now, right, where students are craving this sense of togetherness, the sense of community, but there's also this internal pressure that's happening for them where it's almost like this resistance to be able to get there. So now where there's this access gap, there's this gap where students are in need of the resources, but where is the access for them? And so we want to talk about how can we do more for the students and get them to the place where they need to for that togetherness, for the community piece, and to also help them ease of all the mental health distress that they have gone through. I want to share something very, very specifically where I was able to talk to a student from Florida International University. He's there now as a grad student, was there previously as an undergrad. And I want to actually talk through this entire quote that he has said to me. So he said, "The challenge I face in college that still exists today is the gap of knowledge of transitioning to college as a low-income first-generation student. This challenge for information of the college system is hard to figure out and navigate without other family members that have already gone through these processes and to give guidance. In an ideal world, my student experience would have more resources for academic success, as well as a balance of my college career with my mental and physical health for my betterment." So there's a lot to unpack here. And he's highlighted a lot of great key points here, which is the fact that there is that lack of knowledge. There's that equity gap where for him, in comparison to his own peers, he felt that he had to go and search for the resources a lot more because he didn't know. He didn't have people next to him to help him guide him through college. And so on top of that, he cares a lot about his not only his college career success, but also his mental and physical well-being. And so now is the question of how do we do more for students like him? Students like him who are also trying to do their best in college, but they don't have the resources available to them. So I'm going to pass it over to Krystin to go a little bit deeper on this.
So we need to begin with looking at student success with a different lens in a different way. And I would challenge us to start that process if we haven't already. We think about student success at the macro level, but it really needs to be at the individual level, thinking about it in a granular way. And I love the example that one of our colleagues shared around parenting. As a new mom, it really resonated with me. You can have two kids raised in the same home by the same parents, but the needs will be different. The desires will be different. So parents will need to parent them differently. And we need to think of student success in the same way of an individual. These students are individuals, and that's what we need to treat them as. That's what we need to think of them as when we consider student success. So for the optimal experience, we need to look at this from the perspective of the broader group. It is not solely on the individual. All of these different entities work together in concert collaboratively to support the success of students. So we look at recruitment and financial aid. We think of them, we group them together. As we're recruiting our students, are we understanding the demographics? Are we thinking about diversity and inclusion and the needs that these students will have? We're talking about marginalized groups. We're talking about students of color. So as we're recruiting them in, think about those things and the financial piece. We know that historically marginalized students, students of color have experienced barriers to matriculating and entering colleges and universities. A lot of it is based on funding. So we need to ensure that these tangible needs are met. So those work in concert. And then we have the academic side and the student life. Those work together as well. When we look at curricula, is it designed to be inclusive? Are we thinking about the different learning needs, our support and systems in place, the resources, the programs to ensure that students are able to excel academically? And then Jennifer touched on this as well, the mental health piece, that balance of student life and engagement and the sense of belonging. When students feel that they don't belong, it can definitely have an impact on their mental health. And that also feeds back into attrition and retention of students. So we need to be mindful of that. There are also studies that talk about how students excel academically when they are engaged in student life and activities. So we need to keep that as top of mind when we're thinking about student-centered student success practices. And then workforce development and alumni relations. Are students acquiring the skills they need to be prepared for the workforce? We know that in the workforce, there are disparities for students of color that also contribute to the wealth gap. So we need to ensure that when we're thinking about this model of student success and we're thinking about it on the individual level, are all students acquiring the skills they need to be successful? How are we thinking about the trajectory for students as they matriculate through their respective colleges and universities? And then how can we connect with alumni relations? The quote, I used to hear it a lot, you can't be what you can't see, for students of color and marginalized groups. But in the interest of inclusion, I would say you can't be what you don't know about, what you're not exposed to. And it's very important for us to expose our students to alumni that have been successful, that have matriculated through these various programs. It's student-centered, but it's this model of inclusivity and collaboration. So the topic we've all been waiting for, AI, it is everywhere. We've all been talking about it in the education community. As a faculty member, I've been on both ends of the spectrum of hearing these conversations and engaging in these conversations. Some of it is Jennifer shared, some of it's excitement, the possibilities of what AI can offer, which we're here to talk about, the happy side. But there is some fear, there is some apprehension, and it's because we don't fully understand in the education community what AI is, I think, on a broader scale. So this definition, I want to highlight the latter part of the definition, enhanced processes in place. So AI was not designed to replace or hinder. It was designed to enhance processes that were already in place. And I think about it also when we first got introduced to search engines and Wikipedia. There was apprehension, there was concern. I know faculty members and educators were concerned about academic integrity, and some of these same conversations we were having about search engines, we're having them now about AI. But AI is really an opportunity to enhance and propel our institutions forward. It's automation. As educators, we have to think about efficiency and how to better serve our students. It's adaptive. I know I've been an educator, and many of you as well. We have to adapt. We have to change. We have to be flexible to support this changing workforce and support our students in the best way possible. And then we should be data-driven. What does the data say? How can we use data to inform our practices? How can we use data to ensure that our students are prepared, that they do feel that sense of belonging, that they are engaged on campus, that the curricula does support different learners and their needs? So, and AI is not new. I will turn it over to my colleague, Melissa, to talk more about the inception of AI and all the possibilities.
All right, we're gonna do a little history lesson of AI. Super fun. Jennifer, if you want to kind of bring everything on the screen all at once. AI has been around for a long time, right? Like, this is nothing new. It's just AI in a new way that we're seeing it leveraged, utilized, and kind of deeper. So let's kind of start at the top and work our way down. How did we get to today? Because I think this idea of AI, right, it's been around for a long time. It's been around in education for a long time. But do we understand it? Do we understand what it can truly do for us? Like those benefits that Krystin listed. Can it, you know, are we leveraging it to its fullest potential because of what it was built on? And so, I mean, artificial intelligence has been around since 1950s. You know, it was really developed kind of to, you know, as we were thinking about creating these machines that could think like humans. And it was this possibility of the future, you know, RoboCop and all of those crazy things. And then in the 50s and 60s, it became more, you know, symbolic. And then in the 70s and 80s, it turned to sub-symbolic, where we started to kind of go deeper into what might be possible because of some of the hardware that was kind of developed during that time, where we could process really large data sets. So now AI is starting to see kind of larger and larger data sets that we can kind of bring in and analyze and leverage. In the 90s and 2000s, you know, we really shifted towards this machine learning, which is super exciting. It's this idea that we could create, you know, algorithms and allow computers to learn from data, which is absolutely amazing and phenomenal. And then, you know, neural networks too were created during that time. So lots of stuff. But then where we're at today, well, really, 2021 was when generative AI was first released. It really came out then, and it was really kind of developed as this, you know, how do we understand more? What's the next step of AI? And so I'm going to take a second just to explain what generative AI is, because I think that this is important to kind of ground us and understand kind of all these differentiations. And so generative AI is obviously a, you know, a subfield of artificial intelligence, and it focuses really on creating systems that can generate new examples, such as images with Dolly, or text with ChatGPT-3, or speech with some of the neural advances that have been made from examples from a given data set. And so the goal of generative AI is to develop algorithms that can learn the underlying probability distribution of a given data set and use the knowledge to generate new examples that are similar to the examples in the data set. So generative AI models can be classified in two categories, generative models and discriminative models. Generative models such as GPT-3 that we're seeing today, kind of, you know, all over education, and Dolly, which can create those images, it learns the underlying probability distribution of the data set and generates those new examples from that learned distribution. So kind of machine learning on steroids. And then, you know, the discriminative model, the other side of generative AI, is kind of the neural network. So it learns to differentiate between different classes or categories and can generally focus on used tasks such as images or speech recognition. So again, kind of pulling those two apart for you, but that's kind of where we're at today. So on the next slide, we're going to show just some examples. And these are just some crazy examples that we came up with. I think that I would love to just kind of stop here for just a minute and maybe put on your kind of thinking cap, your creative cap. So we've talked, everybody knows generative AI is out there. What do you see is, how do you see it being leveraged? Or what would you like your craziest idea of how it could be leveraged in education? Go ahead and throw that in the chat. I'd love to see some ideas as you're kind of thinking through. I'll ping around on some of these. We can identify themes, right, in understanding coursework and adapt throughout the semester. We can create kind of artificial special services and paraeducators for students that are available 24/7. oh goodness, when was it? It was early 2010. It was probably 5 to 7 years ago. If you heard about the story from Georgia Tech, where the faculty member embedded a artificial intelligence TA, and they actually got higher ratings than the person TA, the real person TA, because they were available 24/7. So what are your crazy ideas? Let's see some of those. Personalized intervention learning plans. Amazing. Yes. Oh my goodness. Thank you for that. I just showed all of these things to my sister who is an OT. And she was like, imagine the possibilities of what we could kind of bring into, the kind of experiences for students, even in that realm too. Case study analysis. Oh, I love that. I love that one. Student reports. This is great. These are fantastic. Yes, there's so many ways that we can see AI leveraged for good in education. And there's so many possibilities ahead of us. And that's kind of the great thing, right? This is almost a dirt road in front of all of us as educators in education. Like, this is the calculator. Like Krystin said, it's the Wikipedia of today. We get to pave the road for the future of how this is leveraged probably for quite some time in education, which is so exciting. All right, if you want to go to the next slide, I want to kind of ground us in how, like, we got crazy, right? Let's bring us back. And I feel, let's kind of focus in on what's the framework, what's the foundation to make sure that we bring those ideas back, these AI systems, these amazing ideas that we have, and ground them in this conversation of making sure that we are creating inclusive environments that avoid perpetuating biases and discrimination that we know is a huge limitation of AI, machine learning, and even generative AI today. We need to be conscious of those limitations. There was an article that I recently read about just the considerations and the limitations of generative AI. And while we know the possibilities, we also need to know the other end so that we are aware, so that we can implement it in ways that's going to be conducive for learning, conducive for inclusiveness, and can actually help create an inclusive environment, which is what we all want to do as educators. So I'm going to share with you a framework that I think is really helpful for me just to, again, ground these AI systems, these ideas that I have, and making sure that I move any idea that I, crazy idea that I have, which there's a lot in here, that I'm moving forward with a framework to ensure that inclusiveness, to avoid bias, to avoid discrimination. And so the Microsoft's Responsible AI framework is a really nice framework to just kind of learn about and ground in. And after the session, I'll put some links in the chat for everybody on just some resources that you can go through. There's quick learning paths just to kind of listen to these different topic areas that I think is really helpful. And, I think this idea of the framework covering fairness, accountability, transparency, privacy, security, inclusion, all of these things into one is really what we want to aim to do when we create a solution. There are lots of platforms out there, but when you as an educator create a solution, bring even a platform in for your students, basing it on these things can be really helpful. It can help you kind of, develop it in a responsible and ethical manner, which we all hope AI is used for, AI for good. And so there's a few ideas on the right hand side with some resources that we'll also share with you so that you have everything. But I wanted to kind of go through them really quickly because these are big, crazy ideas that are coming to life in real time. This is AI for good. This is everything that we hope AI will be used for. This is the topic of this session, is really creating this inclusive environment and using AI in the best way that we can as educators. And so the good systems is a really cool area in the University of Texas. It's a team that examines how AI can help address racial inequity. And so they're investigating how bias and lack of transparency in technologies can affect different populations, and researching those concerns from an ethical design, development, and sociological perspectives. It's so cool. Check them out. The work that they're doing is absolutely amazing. The second one is a really cool project that came together under Microsoft's AI for Accessibility program. And so Microsoft has a lot of different AI for good efforts, and one of them is for accessibility. And so it's the Mental Health America is working with Northwestern University and the University of Toronto to build adaptive text messaging services to provide more accessible and engaging interventions, which is absolutely amazing, right? So this idea of bringing all of the pieces that we have, putting it under that responsible AI and packaging it up to really impact society in such amazing ways is, right, what we all go into education for. And the last one is really interesting framework that Microsoft has. It's our open education analytics, and it's based on the responsible AI kind of platform. And so it really looks at how we ensure data and AI are used responsibly and ethically across education systems by leveraging and pulling together the data from all the different data silos in higher education. And so I think it's a really interesting project that they're doing there too. So that's a lot. I'm going to pass back to Jennifer to kind of wrap us up with a bow.
Awesome. So I know we're on time and we've had some amazing discussions in the chat. I'm just trying to frantically look at everything and read. But we don't want to leave you guys without any resources or with you guys not being able to connect with us, because I don't know if you can tell, but we're very, very passionate about this. And literally me, Krystin, and Melissa, we sit on a call weekly and just talk about the world every single week, and we just go on and on and on. And so if you want to join that discussion, join it with us, because we want to talk about it. So I'm going to throw in the chat links to connect with us. If you want to access the deck again, you can. We'll have it right here. And don't be a stranger. We're very, very passionate about this, and we're very excited to have been able to talk with you guys about this. And I want to share a reminder with you all. There's a strong equity gap right now, and it's not impossible to close it. And technology really is there to help us, because you don't have to do it on your own. It's not one-to-one, it's one-to-many. So that's all I have to say. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you so much. Thanks, Krystin and Jennifer and Melissa. We appreciate your energy and enthusiasm around this topic, because it definitely is a hot topic. Okay, we're going to go back to me sharing my screen with a few clicks of a button. How about that? Okay, here we go. So just a reminder of what we're asking of you guys is to formulate how might we questions. And that gives us the opportunity to see where we might best focus our energy in our time over this next year through our project cycle. So reframing any challenges and problems that you see into how might we do X, Y, Z. And that was what we will be discussing in our breakout sessions. So hearing from Leonora this morning and Olivier about what circles exist in the Learning Planet Alliance is a great primer for how we're going to approach how we integrate with existing projects or formulate projects that are addressing topics that we haven't seen addressed. And to do that within ASU, we're going to hear from Clarin Collins, who's going to talk to us about Learning Futures Collaboratives and what's happening in Mary Lou Fulton Teachers College. Do we have Clarin with us?
I am here. Good morning.
Good morning, Clarin.
And I am going to share my screen here and run slides.
Absolutely. There you go.
Oops. All right. And I will drop this link in the chat here. Actually, I'll do that after the fact. But I want everyone to have access to this because what I've done is embedded links within this presentation and all the images you're going to see today. So my name is Clarin Collins. I'm the Director of Scholarly Initiatives here at the Mary Lou Fulton Teachers College. And I'm usually the one behind the scenes of the Learning Futures Collaboratives. And this is a really large new research initiative that we have officially gotten underway this past year. And so I'm speaking on behalf of so many people and amazing teams and leaders here at the Teachers College. So I encourage everybody to access this afterwards to learn more because I am a small piece in this giant, amazing, complex puzzle. So today I'm going to go over briefly what the Learning Futures Collaboratives, which because it's a mouthful, we refer to as LFCs, what they are, why they are important, and how to get involved if this is of interest to you. So first, the why and the what. And we have the why and the what because the how and where education happens has been rapidly and significantly changing. If we think about the context in which education is delivered or received, there are a lot of really complicated events that have made this more complex. And this is just a list of some of them up there. Global climate change, rise of technologies, surveillance capitalism, artificial intelligence, the pandemic, increasing numbers of migrants and refugees. So these are a few. And so as a result, we have these teams that are tackling these really complex questions and challenges, considering a lot of the contextual things that I just mentioned. And so what we are doing is trying to address these really large, complicated challenges with interdisciplinary and transdisciplinary teams. The reality is that these questions and challenges are so large and complex that they cannot be addressed by or considered by an individual without the necessary team. And so we have put together like a call for proposals about a year ago after conceptualizing what this could actually look like. And teams responded, and the requirements were that you must have together a collaborative team with differentiated experience and expertise, because again, an individual cannot be able to complexly, or I'm sorry, cannot challenge cannot begin to address these complex issues and challenges without that differentiated experience and expertise. The additional requirement was that these teams be intentionally future focused. In some regard, everything we do with education is future focused because we are teaching people content to be used in the future, preparing people for careers in the future. But the goal for all of these LFCs is that they really be intentional about thinking of what does the future hold for the people included in these LFCs and the issues that they're tackling. So we are supporting these groups through a small grant program, $15,000 or less. And most of this money is being used to support convenings, food needed for these convenings, graduate student research support, speaker honorariums, books, materials that they might need to further investigate these topics. And the teams, again, are made up of faculty, doctoral students or master's level students, researchers and practitioners that are both inside and outside of the university. And we've got some very global engagement with some of these already. So these are the five topics that our LFCs are currently tackling: designing the new American high school, education sustainability and global futures, educating across refugee immigrant networks or the LEARN, futures of artificial intelligence and education and diversity, equity and inclusion, and imagination and futures thinking for K-12. So if you are already like, oh my gosh, this seems incredible and like a lot of work is going on, it is. So I thought I would give a quick preview in the words of some of our participants. So I'm going to show this quick video and then give you a highlight of what each of the groups are currently working on.
Often people feel that the future is just something that happens to them. And we want to change that perspective. We want young people to see that their decisions matter and that their voice matters.
We need to position youth with a voice and with the capacity to act and influence the global future that we're all a part of.
We're really rooted in those kind of urgent questions of right now. The future is demanding far more and something actually quite different.
And the real broad question is, who needs to weigh in on this, right? And how can we get these people together? And then what can we do?
Again, when we're talking about broad, wicked questions in education, they're not going to be solved by just one person or even by a small group of people. They need a large group of folks who can come together with different resources, responsibilities, different passions to tackle these big issues.
I think this is what the Learning Futures Collaboratives are all about, is breaking down these silos and creating space for our faculty to connect and explore possibilities in ways that we might not typically or ordinarily.
Some of the LFCs are both drawing on folks from different units across campus, but also from the community. In fact, we've got plans to work with other universities and institutions across the world. We need to be thought partners. We need to be challenging things. We need to be making mistakes intellectually. And when we need to be doing that with others.
Those kinds of experiences seem powerful because multiple visions get out there and people can play with them together. People can seed each other's imaginations, even in small ways, about the possibilities for the future.
The outcome isn't about simply producing a paper. This is about bringing networks together and forging an alliance and a vision.
I truly believe we have to change the way in which we think about research, educational research, scholarship, and sort of the future of learning.
We are in a world where change is happening faster and faster than ever before. To create better futures, we need to form a community that doesn't just include an academic audience. This work is in service towards our youth, in service towards young people, to show them that the future is something that they can shape and they can build, and we're going to give them the tools to be able to do that.
Awesome. So what a great trailer or preview for the LFCs. And again, all of these images here link to each LFC's website. And you'll notice on these slides, as I very briefly go over what each of these LFCs are investigating, the focus is truly on this future-focused research question, and the teams are so large that I couldn't fit individual names on these slides. So I just want to reiterate that these challenges, these questions that these groups are tackling, require so many people and expertise and experiences on board. So that's why you're not seeing the names of individuals here, but on the website, it is included so you can know who to reach out to. So the Imagination and Futures Thinking Group, every bold slide up here, I'm sorry, the question right underneath the title is the future focused question that they're tackling, which I won't read to you, but I wanted to try to give you an example with their approach of what these guys are actually working on. So one way that this working group is looking at how to integrate futures thinking into K-12 is they've developed a workshop, which is actually a game that can be used with middle school students to help them take agency into designing their own unique equitable futures. With the Futures of Artificial Intelligence and Education and DEI, they are interested in looking at how AI can transform education, but always ensuring that there's a human-centered approach, a human-centered design to integrate and inform critical issues of diversity, equity, and inclusion. Designing the New American High School, this is a little bit of a play on the New American University. This group is bringing together scholars and practitioners from inside and outside of the AASU community to kind of look at examples of innovative high school models, understand the various barriers and challenges to the educational system, and then also look at successful reform effort in recent years. So they're bringing people together who have all these different experiences. Education, sustainability, and global futures. This group is really thinking about how to reimagine and reconfigure education towards the future and survival of the planet and the people on it. So far, they have four strands of research: the learning, research, engagement, and institutions and systems. And across these four strands, they have 11 working groups currently. And just one example of a project that cuts across each of those four strands is that they are creating a new master's degree program. And the unique tie-in here is that the thesis requires involvement and collaboration with a community organization to think about sustainable futures. Learn is really focused on critical conversations. This group has our most global reach right now. They have brought together refugees, educators, and researchers from global and community organizations to really make sure people are recognizing and aware of all the different education of refugees and immigrants. Okay, I thought that was last. And so the reality is we are just getting started. I want to reiterate that this work is so complex that it can't be neatly completed within a grant cycle. So this is our first official year of funding these LFCs, which is primarily being used across all of them as like network and community building, developing the background knowledge that they'll need to continue this work. Year two will likely be more conceptualized research agendas. But we are really at that point of sharing out the work that these groups are involved in and wondering who else might need to be at the table. What perspectives have we not yet included? So if any of this sounds interesting to you, or if you know of other organizations that should be connected, we really do encourage you to reach out. And lastly, this is one slide and an article from Ed Researcher, but it is education is in the need of creative invention to make it work better. So at the end of the day, we're all looking forward to finding ways to think about education and make sure we have a future in which we can continue to deliver it. And lastly, I just want to share all the images from this slide and that you'll see on the website as you visit were from Dolly 2, which is an open AI platform that creates images. So just wanted to give that little shout out. And that is it. I will drop the link to this presentation in the chat, which again, you can visit all of the unique websites, and I encourage anyone to reach out, and I'm happy to connect you with who you would best be connected with. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Clarin. That was amazing. So I would just remind everyone that we've seen Clarin's LFC projects. We've heard from our friends at Learning Planet. So we know that projects exist out there. So we don't want to operate in silos. We want to convene everyone in a very purposeful and meaningful way. We don't want to reinvent the wheel. How can we best use, as a community, our time and energy to help advance existing projects? And if we don't see something that has already been created, what do we create and move forward into these existing frameworks so that we can make more of an impact? So with that, we will kick it over to our friends from, We will kick it over to Nick and Kelly from Digital Promise, and we will hear from them about Playful Pedagogy. Welcome to Nick and Kelly.
Thank you so much. Kelly, do you want to kick us off?
Absolutely. Thanks, Stephanie. We're very excited to be here. And so without further ado, thumbs up, everyone can see my screen. Awesome. Well, welcome to our session on playful learning. And we're gonna talk about developing playful pedagogy with gamification and game-based learning. I'm Kelly McNeil. I am a learning experience designer here at Digital Promise. Very excited, I've been here for about a month now. Previously, I was with Arizona State University supporting national programs with teachers in maker learning environments through professional learning experiences. So previously I was a computer science certified teacher and makerspace teacher. I am currently researching effective hybrid professional learning programs supporting inquiry-based learning and maker technologies, much like gamification and game-based learning. I'll pass it over to my partner in crime, Nick.
Kelly makes it sound like I'm like a professional poacher. Like, yep, by the way, she works for Digital Promise now. She used to work for ASU. I promise you that is not what happened here, but we are super happy to have Kelly having joined our team, the Learning Experience Design team at Digital Promise. My name is Nick Schiner. Frequently go by Obi-Wan Nakobi on social media. So please make sure you follow both of us and connect with us for after the presentation, the breakout room, and all of that great stuff. I am the program director for Maker Learning at Digital Promise, as well as a lot of our peer-to-peer professional learning communities. Those include our Reinvent the Classroom program, which is in partnership with Microsoft, HP, and Intel. So I was really excited to see the Microsoft AI work there. I was frantically sending that via Slack to the rest of our team. Some work on the Siena Solutions Challenge in partnership with Siena out of Canada, and a number of other amazing programs as well. Former fourth and fifth grade classroom teacher, technology integration specialist, worked in central office for Baltimore County Public Schools for a number of years, where I was responsible for all of the maker learning work in the district. So 175 school centers and programs, making sure they all had robust access to maker learning experiences. Have been here at Digital Promise for about 4.5 years, and we're really excited to talk about playful learning. Let's go. Oh wow, I tried to do my air horn and I played the trombone sound, so I'm sorry for that. Here we go. There we go. All right, let's go. So about Digital Promise, we are a global nonprofit. We were originally born out of Congress, but we now exist as our own national, international nonprofit, where we work at the intersection of education, research, and technology to design, investigate, and scale innovations alongside communities that support learners, particularly those who are historically and systematically excluded. I'd encourage you, if you have time, please be sure to visit our website and check out our North Star goals, which is our 10-year plan for the change that we want to make in the coming years.
So just to give a quick overview, this is a rapid fire, very quick presentation we're doing today. Nick and I chatted about how much we're both gamers, by the way, and streamers. So like, just side note, like this topic is extremely passionate for us. But in 20 minutes, we wanted to try to give you as much of a scratching the surface view of some of these topics in education that we could. So we're going to kind of define this in go over some like shared vocabulary and give you a few examples of what it looks like. We're going to kind of talk about the why and, why is it relevant and meaningful to us, and kind of look at some of the existing research. And then we'll briefly cover a few examples of how, if you want to learn more and how to get started, and where we will be going in our breakout session.
Okay. Start with an easy one. I'm hopefully lobbing up a softball question here. So drop it. Feel free to drop it in the chat. What game is this? I'm hoping this one's familiar. This was my very first game, SMB. Yep. So Eric, I see you're giving us the info without it. There you go, Sarah. Nice job. This is Super Mario Brothers, Nintendo Entertainment System. This is a formative moment for me. I remember vividly getting my Nintendo, the Super Mario Brothers and Duck Hunt combo game, which was absolutely amazing. Fun fact, if you did not already know this, in Duck Hunt, if you plug in a second controller, you can actually control the duck. Never knew that until like a year or two ago. Really super cool. Really hard to play it now because it doesn't work with modern televisions because of the LED technology rather than CRT, but that's not what we're really here for today. So how do games make you feel? When you play games, whether they're video games, board games, role-playing games like Dungeons and Dragons that are more narrative-based, how do games make you feel? Oh, John, you're making me feel really old that you said you grew up on your dad's Super Nintendo. Oh my God.
Nick, what I want to know is on your soundboard, do you have the dog laughing? That's
I don't. I need to change this a little bit on my soundboard so that I don't accidentally hit the wrong things, and I have some super cool ones. Grew up on an Apple II, love that. Atari 2600. Okay, now we're closer aligned with where I was. So you see, engaged, addicted. I don't like to use addicted, but we can talk about that a little bit later. Competitive, excited, engaged again, focused and skilled, free, creative, absolutely. Bored. Oh no. I hope not. That's okay. Not everybody loves games, and that's okay too. And remember, we talk about games like everything we talk about, just like anything we talk about in education. Right tool, right time, right audience. So bored, okay, we can work with that. Maybe we find something that you like. I see lots of really great answers here, but I do want to move into the last question, which is the one that's going to lead us into our content for today. What game elements or mechanics do you see in this image? I say GIF, Kelly says GIF. We're not going to get into that argument, but that's why we say image. It is an image. Wait, go back. Sorry.
Someone had complained about the moving image, so I
knew. Oh, sorry. sorry about that, Leanne. So thinking about what you saw in there, no, Kelly, move off of it. Yeah, I don't want to bother anybody with that, and we can't stop that right now. Sorry about that, Leanne. Think about some of the elements that we saw on that screen there. and some of the actions that you saw happening there. What, okay, so I'm seeing Eric saying objectives, power-ups, there's an antagonist there. Anything else? Oregon Trail, you're nice. I love Oregon Trail. So there was repetition, there was movement, jumping, collecting points. Absolutely, there was a point counter up there. There was no monetization. Super Mario Brothers was not pay to win. It certainly wasn't even, it was pay to play, and then you played and that was it. Gratification, absolutely. Some other things that you see, there were lives there, so you got the opportunity to try things over again, the opportunity to play it, mess up, go back and start again. Lots of really great elements that you thought of. Thank you so much for naming them. You can please feel free to continue dropping those in the chat. But I want to move into the what. And so I always like to start any presentation we do about games-based learning, gamification, esports, with this image and this text, because I think it's really important that we help folks understand the difference between these things. I'm thinking of like a tri Venn diagram I need to create. If you're familiar with Digital Promise at all, we're obsessed with Venn diagrams. So I do need to make that at some point. But the terms that I need you to know for today, esports, particularly scholastic esports, is organized competitive gaming, video gaming. Some games that you would see in that is Rocket League, NBA 2K, Super Smash Brothers, League of Legends, Fortnite, Donkey Kong. Those are some pop, I love. If you've ever seen King of Kong, it was a great movie. There was a whole cheating scandal that came after that. I highly recommend you check that out. But esports is organized competitive video gaming. We're actually not really gonna talk about that today. There is certainly crossover with it, but we're not really gonna spend our time talking about that today. Where we're really gonna spend our time talking is about games-based learning and gamification. When we talk about games-based learning, we are talking about a learning experience within a game framework or within a game. Yes, absolutely. And that includes the development of building that game. So it is a learning experience where you are building a game or you are taking part in a game. And some examples that we have for that is Minecraft Education and the Oregon Trail. It is also, as Kim pointed out, using things like Unreal Engine, Scratch, Unity to develop game Twine if you're interested in building text-based narrative games. Any of those is a games-based learning experience. Absolutely, D&D is making a huge comeback. And then we also have gamification. Gamification is the use of gaming elements like points, achievements, and quests as extrinsic motivation for doing something. In this case, some of the familiar ones that you probably know, Kahoot is gamification, assigning points for answering questions that you need kids to know the answers to. Class Dojo, which is gamification a lot of times of behavior in the classroom, both positive and negative. And then the idea of house points. I know house points, house parties, really big in my son's kindergarten class and in the whole school right now, making sure behaviors are what they are supposed to be. But it's this idea of gamifying things in everyday life to increase motivation to do what is being asked. So we can go to the next slide, Kelly. And I think that's you.
This is perfect. Fantastic. So yeah, I'm seeing lots of great conversation in the chat about what examples of gamification are, what game-based learning is. Again, in the amount of time we have, we're just scratching the surface. You guys are bringing up lots of amazing points and concepts that we want to talk about. In particular, we picked this clip out. This is the Minecraft EDU creator. And so we wanted to play this video just to give you a short little introduction about how he has used this in his class. It shows some of the kids hands-on. Some of the things I want you to think about as you're watching it is, have you used gamification or game-based learning in your context? What has been successful or what has not been successful? And then towards the end of this video, he shares something about other traditional methods and this idea of, you know, we don't want game-based learning to supplant everything else. It's not that we all hear there's no silver bullet. It's the same thing here. There's no silver bullet. So just thinking about your thoughts here, and I'm going to actually, I realize I'm going to stop sharing and reshare because this happens every time I share something. I did not click that tiny little button at the bottom. Assume not have this as a default. We're going to talk about this in the Classroom of 2050 project. Please make sharing sound default. Here we go.
So if you guys watched our Minecraft and EDU episode from a couple weeks ago, you remember that we mentioned something called Minecraft EDU made by Minecraft teacher, AKA Joel Levin, who we happen to have in the studio today. So I'm really curious about the moment at which you were like, okay,
The aha moment?
Yeah, like I'm a teacher, I'm gonna teach using Minecraft.
Minecraft is just this rare game that kids of all ages really enjoy playing.
Right, right.
And both boys and girls. It was over summer break 2010, I think. I was playing an alpha version of Minecraft with my daughter, who was not even quite 5 at the time. She learned to spell her first word because of Minecraft.
What was it?
She wanted to know how to teleport herself back home.
Okay.
And you had to type slash H-O-M-E.
So like, what are the things that you teach using Minecraft? Like, what are the subjects?
I tend to teach just sort of digital citizenship, the idea of how we treat each other online. What I'll do is I'll put the kids in these little situations where they have to work together, and maybe there's limited resources, or I often set different groups of kids with competing goals. And I've never found a better motivator to get the kids to learn how to do their own research on the internet than Minecraft. But that's just me in my own classroom. There's teachers having kids fly through 3D models of cells. There's teachers having the kids fly around the world, collect a lot of data, and then represent that data in graphs. One of the problems that a lot of people have identified, and I had trouble sort of seeing past myself, was that, well, Minecraft isn't a very realistic simulation of the world.
Right, sometimes, everything's in a block.
Yeah, and sometimes you cut down a tree and, you know, the block doesn't fall, that kind of thing. But what a lot of science teachers are doing is they're having kids map the physics of this world, and where is it the same as the real world, and where is it different?
Okay.
And they're having the kids design the experiments to chart this difference. It's teaching the scientific method using Minecraft.
I feel like there's this criticism of things like teaching using Minecraft and maybe game-based learning in general.
I don't think that game-based learning should supplant any traditional learning methods. What it's about for me is using a teaching tool that is really relevant to these kids. When they're in the moment, when they're in the game, when they're in a world that I've created block by block, surrounded by content that I want them to learn, I have never had such access to the brains of these children. And it's been really rewarding for me professionally. And the science is starting to catch up with this. It's been really fascinating to see some early work being done to prove that there is a direct connection between this increased engagement and the amount of information that children are retaining.
So if there are teachers out there who want to get started teaching with Minecraft, what's the first step? What's the thing that you recommend?
Well, they can go to my website, minecraftedu.com, and we have some materials to get started and some ideas for things you can do with the game.
So I think that's everything that we have to ask for right now. Joel, I want to thank you so much for coming in. And for everybody who's interested in Joel and his work, we'll put a bunch of links in the description so you can check it out. It's amazing.
Thank you.
So Kelly, I want to just pop in here really quickly and don't visit that link because it's not going to do you any good, because does anybody know why? Anybody?
It's Microsoft now. Like Microsoft.
Yeah, it's Microsoft.
Yeah, it's not.
Microsoft saw the value there and has the actual Minecraft Education Edition now. So if you're interested in Minecraft for Education, that's where you want to go. We want to make sure we point you in the right direction. They saw the value in it once they had acquired it and saw that there was value in building out an education-specific version of it. And it is one of the most popular teaching tools that's out there right now.
But yeah, and you know, we don't get paid or sponsored by Minecraft Education or Minecraft EDU, but it's one of those tools, and we wanted to show you the different ways and some of the ideas and some of the concepts that they're being talked about in there. I'm trying to keep an eye on our time, and Stephanie and Laura, you keep me heads up on it too, because I know things have been on and off. We're getting a little bit closer, but Nick, I believe this is you leading us into this next section.
Absolutely. So I'll make this short and simple. Why? Why games in education? Why games-based learning? Why gamification? The easiest way to answer that question is by citing one of the preeminent experts in this, who is Jane McGonigal. If you're not familiar with Jane's work, I highly recommend you check it out. The TED Talk that she's done, I think she's done a number of them, but her original one was one of the formative reasons why I was so interested in this, besides the fact that I just love video games. But games make us happy because they are hard work that we choose for ourselves. And it turns out that almost nothing makes us happier than good hard work. The idea that we can do good hard things in games, with games, by creating games or using elements of games to make things feel better to us when we enjoy them. And again, not for everybody, but for a vast majority of the world, that play is something that we all crave and we also crave hard work. So you put them together and you have what can be an incredible learning experience.
And a lot of these references that we have been talking about, these resources, these links, Jane has a fantastic TED Talk. We have actually linked all of these in the Whova platform prior to this presentation, and we'll make sure that you get access to those. This slide right here just kind of highlights a few of the bullet points related to the science and the research that even the Minecraft EDU creator was alluding to. But according to research, gamification and game-based learning and these sort of elements within the classroom do lead to increased participation and engagement with students. There have been shown studies for social emotional learning connections and attention and focus, particularly of interest for me, because I am a parent. I have two kids. One of them has ADHD, and the attention and focus has been studied specifically among students that are ADHD and neurodiverse. So I have personally seen at home, and Nick and I have actually shared stories of our own kids being engaged. This is just a little graphic that comes from one of the research articles that we have linked that is looks like a Digital Promise graphic, as you were talking about earlier, Nick, that we like to make, but really some good stuff out there. Not much time to deep dive into it, but we really encourage you to look at these and hope that we will bring some of these concepts up in our breakout room and chat a little more about them. Which brings us into our very last little column of talking points here, which is how. If you want to do this, if you've never heard of it, which it sounds like most of you have heard of this and have explored it in your own context, but there are those educators out there who haven't done this and who don't know about it. And that's part of my passion and my research is actually reaching out to either tech-averse teachers or teachers that just aren't digging a whole lot into tech. And how do you get started? Where do you get started? There are lots of ways to do it, lots of different, whether it's analog or whether it's digital. I picked out this specific video clip from Edutopia because I like how it actually shows both analog. You see right here on the screen, the Lego set that they're using in a sort of game element type thing here. This video is gonna sort of talk about classroom assessment. So this is just one element that you can actually take a look at and how you might look at putting gamification or game-based learning mechanics in your classroom. So we're gonna just watch this. As you look at it though, kind of look at the ideas, think about, does it relate to your context? And what are other ways that you might incorporate this?
Games are great ways to assess student learning in action. They can help you figure out what your students know and how they think. Any kind of game has the power to make student thinking and doing visible, not just digital games. Choices that students make during gameplay provide lots of data about what they do and don't understand, and how they apply skills like critical thinking and problem solving. Games also provide immediate feedback to students about their choices so they can take control of their own learning. This frees you up to evaluate more than just content knowledge and skills for a deeper understanding of what students are learning. And the best part about using games as assessments is that sometimes students have so much fun playing a game, they don't even realize they're being assessed.
Three, two, one, go!
Yay! So, how do you assess student learning using a game? Step one, produce a product. Students can create something during gameplay to show what they are learning. For example, the goal of a card game might be for students to write a collaborative story based around the cards they are dealt. Step two, question students. You can develop a list of probing questions to ask students during gameplay. As students play, move around the classroom and ask those questions. Step three, track moves. Ask students to track the moves they make during gameplay. At the end of the game, you can evaluate the choices they made while playing. Step one, mod a game.
I am going to go ahead and pause that because I know our time is getting short. I know we're right on the brink of it here, and I don't want to leave us without some of the links, some of the resources, and just kind of like open it up for any last final thoughts from anyone or anything from Nick, but we really appreciate your time spent and really looking forward to expanding on these ideas more with ShapingEDU and coming up with some potential opportunities for action.
Fantastic. Thank you, Nick and Kelly. Nick,
absolutely. Thank
you. One more.
No, I just wanted. I just wanted to say thank you very much. I appreciate it, and thank you to Kelly for doing all this hard work to get us ready for today. There we go.
Thank you, Nick and Kelly. So, what we're going to do now? I'm going to share my screen quickly here. Okay, we are moving on to the. The last little bit here in which we do breakout sessions, and we're listening and we're watching what you guys are talking about in chat, and we're going to formulate things accordingly. And so I would ask you during this last session to, as we're listening to Robert, hi Robert, talk to us about what we're going to learn from the wonderful world of micro-credentials and democratizing and decentralizing education. You again, think through the how might we statement. And so we're going to take all of the ones that we've created throughout the day today and bring those into our breakout session. So to wrap up our speaker portion of the event, we are going to welcome Robert. Hi, Robert.
Hello, everybody. I'm just going to go ahead and share my screen here. So let me get this all loaded up. It's been a real joy listening to these sessions, by the way. Clarin mentioned something, and it reminded me of a quote, that greatness and creativity are in the agency of others. It's a quote that I kind of reverberate through my memory. And then just Nick and Kelly's presentation on gamification really resonates with me, because before I got into this whole micro-credential thing, I was a classroom teacher, but we'll talk a little bit about that in a moment. So let me share my presentation here. Okay, cool. Can everybody see it? Right on. And I don't have a soundboard, but I do have hotkeys. So I might throw some confetti in every once in a while. I'm not like a pro streamer or anything, but I'm always looking for ways to make virtual theme less virtual, you know what I mean? So like that engagement can really help. So without further ado, I'm gonna talk to you guys a little bit today about the democratization and decentralization of education journeys. And my name is Robert Bager. I'm the founder and CEO of my own company, Micro-Credential Multiverse. And before I started, you know, my own company and all that, I actually worked with Digital Promise. So I think I might have been like right as Nick was starting. It was kind of like the tail end of my tenure there. But it was really exciting that Digital Promise was taking gamification really seriously, which is at the time something, you know, that not a lot of folks were really doing. They were applying the research, they were doing the work, they were showing the engagement. So it's just really cool to see that journey come full circle. And congratulations to Kelly getting her role at Digital Promise. I'm sure she's going to continue to fit in swimmingly. It's a great organization and definitely worth checking out. Those links that they shared at the tail end of their presentation, I'm going to be checking them out, so you should too. Okay, so let me make sure that it progressed a slide. So we got to the slide with my face on it, right? Okay, sometimes it doesn't progress for some reason. All right, so I'm Robert Bager, and I live in a skill-based world. So I wanted to add some of the skills that I sort of bring to the table for my clients and for the work that I've done over the past 10 years or so in the micro-credential space. Actually, when I joined Digital Promise, there was like 3 people. I think the whole company was like 8 people or something like that. So it's also been fun to watch their organization grow over time. But the unique skills that I bring are skills. So like talking about skills, what are they, identifying them, all that good stuff. Digital badges. So You know, I got involved in the open badges work pretty early on when Mozilla was doing the work before they handed it over to Concentric Sky, Badger, and IMS Global, these sorts of things. And digital badges really have gone from a nice to have to a need to have rapidly. And we'll talk a little bit of that during this conversation, but I just wanted to add some more things here. So digital wallets. So once you earn a credential, where does it live? So it might live in a backpack, it might live in a learner record, but sort of a general way of defining those things is as digital wallets, basically like digital storage devices that you keep on your phone and your computer. They hold all your digital badges and credentials and things. Another topic area that I specialize in is in skills descriptors. So thinking critically about when you say a skill like collaboration, what do you actually mean? So going deep on skills is sort of the realm of skill descriptors, and then micro-credentials. So this is kind of what gets me up in the morning every day. So you can head over to my website, micro-credential multiverse. I bought another domain that's easier to remember, micro-credential.xyz. So you can head over to either of those sites, or you can just Google it. I'm pretty good with SEO. So micro-credentials and then learning pathways. So these are kind of the topic areas that I find myself talking about most frequently. But ultimately what I love to do is unite learning experiences with meaningful recognition. And I'm just gonna move along here. Where did it start? So, you know, who am I? Why did I get into this whole thing? And like many of the presenters, I was a classroom teacher. So I started out over a decade ago as a K-12, they actually put me in a sixth grade the first year, which was amazing because I liked sixth grade, but I was a little afraid to teach sixth grade because I know that a lot of my friends did not love sixth grade. So when they made me a sixth grade teacher, I really went nuts. And we were building buildings and greenhouses and designing, you know, trees and writing poetry. It was really beautiful. But a year after I was a sixth grade teacher, they put me in the high school. They realized I had a science degree. So they were like, what are we doing? We need to make this guy a high school science teacher. There's like a shortage of these. And literally the first day that I was a teacher, I kind of went through a transformative experience that I'm sure most educators can relate with, but I wasn't really ready for it. And I walked into the classroom and I just gave like a quick quiz, you know, where are all my students at? I had 126 of them. So like, where are you at? And the results were not great, really not great. And actually they were not great in things that I wasn't really prepared to talk about that year. You know, literacy, empathy, collaboration, like these are actually the things that I assessed on day one. And the results weren't that great. So I basically looked at my students and I was like, hey, you know, what's going on here? Like, why, you know, aren't you guys really ready for my class, frankly? And they were like, what do you expect, mister? We're from, and I'm not gonna tell you, you know, the district I was teaching in, that's not appropriate, but it was a very high need district and it was right where I grew up, actually. It was like the town next to where I came from. And they said, what do you expect, mister? We're from, you know, name the school. And I like, it hit so hard, like right in the heart. I was like, oh my God, the first thing I need to work on is these kids' expectations, really. Like I really needed to earn their trust so that I could really work on their confidence before I even got into their confidence. And this was very formative for me. I talk about this, you know, every chance I get because, you know, we talk about, you know, we're going to talk about democratization and decentralization and these sorts of things, but actually all of these things are in service to the greater goal of making these kids really see success, not just work towards it. They have to see it before they even start that journey. So we're going to talk a little bit about education journeys in this conversation, but I wanted to stop and share that formative experience with you and kind of give you that background. Okay. So getting back to business, I'm really gonna touch on three key questions here on democratization and decentralization of education journeys. We're gonna do it in three acts. So like most great, you know, plays, it's three acts. You know, sometimes they're five, but sometimes they're three. So first we're gonna talk about why are learning and recognition systems shifting towards increased democratization and decentralization? the whole market is headed this way. Why, right? Let's start with Simon Sinek's why. Next, we're going to talk about what. So, okay, you get it. What can you do to adapt to the evolving demands of an increasingly democratic and decentralized world? What can you do? And then finally, how do I get started? Like very tangibly, what can I start doing today to sort of set myself up and my community of learners up for success? So those are going to be the three key questions for this discussion. And I'm going to keep on keeping on. Although I'm going to pause for a second because I'm going to throw my LinkedIn in the chat just in case anybody wants to get in touch with me and they have to break at some point. So first, why decentralization? So let's talk about that. So when I was thinking about this topic, it's a big topic, but like decentralization and democratization, it's a big topic. I could have taken this conversation in a dozen different directions, but I really wanted to start with you. How do you spend your time? And Oprah Winfrey, I really admire her and her work. She tends to believe that how you spend your time defines who you are. So it's very much a you are what you eat, right? You are what you consume. You are what you spend your time doing. And I actually think that this is exactly right. We all have some amount of time, and how we choose to spend that time has very much to do with our identity and how we see the identity of others. So when we think about this basic question, how do we spend our time? Well, it got me thinking, where do most people spend their time? Well, most Americans spend over 8 hours a day online, full-time job online. This includes time spent while at work, streaming media at home, and perpetually attempting to cut down on social media. I know it's like February, so some people in January said, oh, I want to spend less time on social media. I don't know how well you guys are doing. I deleted Reddit. I deleted Twitter. I'm like over it at this point. I spend most of my time on LinkedIn, so that's why I added my link in the chat. But I'm not alone. Most Americans spend over 8 hours, most, on online. And this number, as you can see, has just been going up. So it's not, you know, we haven't plateaued. It wasn't like peak online during COVID. We just keep going online more and more. And there are good reasons for this. But this evolving relationship comes with a new set of challenges. So identity theft, for example. So identity theft cost Americans about $5.8 billion annually. So this is everything from having your credit card number stolen to, you know, losing the keys of your crypto wallet. You know, like it really runs the gamut of how, you know, you can actually have your identity stolen online and what that actually means financially. But the FTC, so the Trade Commission here in the United States, received about 5.5 million total fraud and identity theft reports annually, where 1.5 million or so are consumer identity theft cases. So that's you and me, right? Not businesses and universities. We'll talk about that. $2.8 billion of losses were from imposter scams. So just people who, you know, are pretending to be somebody else, basically. That's kind of the definition there. And that fraud cases were up 70% from 2020 to 2021. And again, that number is just going up increasingly. So, and this is from the National Council on Identity Theft Prevention. Okay, now let's talk about institutions, right? So there are a lot of people in the audience here from schools, whether they're K-12, colleges, institutions, you name it. The average total cost of a breach for an institution is around $5 million. So these are just numbers, just to ground our conversation, to make sure that we understand the stakes. And this is generally when a business or a university email is compromised, right? Oh, you know, accidentally someone gets my password, they have access to my email. Now the ensuing hack, which, you know, is not inexpensive. And specifically, the costs on this are rising. So like all the other numbers I'm giving you, generally the cost of this is about 10% year over year. Every year it gets more expensive. And that credentials, interestingly enough, are the most common attack vector. So like your login credentials are precious. That's kind of where this whole thing starts. And compromised credentials, being the most common initial attack vector, are responsible for about a fifth. So so 20% of the breaches. And this is these numbers were brought about by IBM Security. They do an annual security review checklist. And when it comes to education, again, the stakes are even higher. You know, if you have $5, $10 stolen out of your Venmo, not the end of the world. But if you're an institution of higher education and suddenly someone who is not Robert Bajor has access to Robert Bajor's credentials, this can be a really big problem. And to go back to how we're framing this conversation, this is a consequence of centralization. When you put all of your important stuff in one place, it's basically like ringing a dinner bell, right? And saying like, come and get it. This is where all the value is. And this is a consequence of centralized sort of data and specifically in a higher education context. So if you want more information about all that security stuff, I actually put the slides on Whova. So if you go to Whova and you can download the slides, all that kind of sort of thing, I kind of did all that ahead of time. So if you're already asking, are the slides going to be available? They will be available. They already are available. Okay, so we talked a little bit about decentralization. And again, I could have touched on a variety of topics, but I'm sort of going the high strategy level. There's individual weeds that you can get into. Let's talk about democratization. Okay, so democratization is a really interesting idea, democratization of education journeys specifically, because there are a number of parallel trends that are transforming skills gaps into something that many countries, like Australia, for example, have called a skills emergency. And by further democratizing education journeys, you can address those individual skills gaps and then at a national and sort of international level, those skills emergencies. So these trends are broken down into three main categories. There are social trends, economic trends, and technological trends. And they demand more from learners, from employers, and education providers, both within the United States and wherever, whatever country you may find yourself in. Okay, so first let's talk about those social and economic trends. So fundamental disruptions in local and global labor markets increasingly demand that learning experiences have tangible market outcomes to address, you know, what we've said before is the skills emergency. So these are just social and economic trends, basically, that are contributing to disruptions in local and global labor markets because there really isn't a good fit between the skills and I will credit Lightcast with this dichotomy because I really like it. The skills that are taught versus the skills that are sought. I really like that dichotomy. So what skills are you teaching and what skills are, you know, recognized or stakeholders like employers actually looking for in the employees that they ultimately hire? So I'm gonna move ahead here. So the second set of sort of parallel trends are around job and labor markets. So in evaluating job applicants, employers are more commonly suspending the use of degree completion as a proxy and instead now favor hiring on the basis of demonstrated skills and competencies. So this was a quote from an article in the Harvard Business Review. You'll notice in the presentation, I use quotes, I use stats, I use facts. You don't need to take my word for it kind of thing. And then the final thing is, I also just wanted to add this little fun fact, which is that over half of adults prefer non-degree pathways. So that's another interesting sort of reality of this democratization of education journeys. So that we're really meeting demands that currently exist. This isn't, you know, something that we're doing out of the kindness of our heart. This is really rising to the occasion of the current economic and labor market reality. And in 2020, interest has shifted towards non-degree pathways specifically, and where half of adults that were interviewed by Strata actually preferred those non-degree pathways. So let me go back and summarize. We'll teach your skills here. You're going to notice I'm going to go back and summarize. So why decentralization? We talked a little bit about privacy. We talked a little bit about security, and we really hit on a lot of the costs there. And I'm going to get into the privacy and security a little bit more. And then when it comes to why democratization, you know, really there's three parallel trends that are pushing education systems and journeys towards greater democratization. So social and economic trends, labor market trends, And then there's technology trends, which actually were covered in other sessions today during the summit. So if you want to go back into some of those other conversations, especially around technology, the rise of artificial intelligence, big data, self-sovereign identity, you know, there's actually a lot in each of these individual trends. But again, for the sake of brevity, I wanted to name just a few examples. Okay, so we covered the why, and there's a lot more. I just covered a little bit of the why. Now we'll get into the what can you do about it. But before I get into the what can you do about it, I wanted to just reference Huva because I set up a poll and I asked folks, I said, and let me move a little zoom out of the way. Okay, so how are you preparing for the decentralization and democratization of education journeys? A question that I asked the audience. And I gotta move, fighting with Zoom here, all right. Okay, so they said, so educate local communities on how to make sure their voices are heard. I think that's really, really great, by the way, because the two most frequently asked questions in micro-credentials, a poll done by Holon IQ every year. First question was, what are they? What are micro-credentials, right? So it starts really with education, not just implementing the technology for your learners, but also getting that buy-in by educating your community on what exactly micro-credentials are. The second most popular micro-credential related question is, how do I know if they're any good? There's over a million credentials as of Credential Engine's credential count for 2022, another great article that you guys can access, it's free online. How do you know if they're any good? So educating local communities is really a big part of that. I'm not gonna read all these, but some of the other ones that I really liked were thinking of ways it could work in the current structures and how the structures themselves have to change. It's a systematic change. I love that response to the poll question on Huva. And by the way, you can drop into Huva and you can add your own responses to these poll questions. And then I'll read one more. So I like this one a lot. So being comfortable with change and excited for spreading knowledge and resources. If you've spent any amount of time with people who are working on micro-credentials or gamification, they are a excited batch. They're really, you know, for a long time, it was a nice to have, not a need to have. And this entire shift is really contingent on the enthusiasm by the people who are carrying the torch. So people like Kelly and Nick in the previous session, you know, these people have been, you know, carrying this torch for a while, and most of them are educators themselves. So I just wanted to pause and read some of those poll responses. So thank you for responding to the poll in Huva, and you can drop in at any time and you can add your responses. Okay, so what can you do about it? All right, first thing that I recommend is to adopt a skills-based approach. So we talked about degrees as a proxy for professional learning. I'm gonna drop another reference here. Todd Rose's End of Average is one of the best books ever written. And he talks a lot about jagged learning profiles and micro-credentials and skills and these sorts of things. He's not alone, okay? The shift to skills-based learning isn't just something that we're doing out of the kindness of our heart. It really adds more precision and fidelity to rapidly evolving labor markets. This is a strategic advantage for your institution or if you're an employer within your company. And this approach is being adopted nationally by governments as well. Australian government, the EU, the United States, there's been tens of billions of dollars appropriated for skills-based education and learning in strategic sectors of the US economy, both in the CHIPS Act and the Inflation Reduction Act. So this isn't a, you know, come and go trend, which we see in education all the time. This is really the next step in a metamorphosis of how we're serving our learners. So why would you want to adopt a skills-based approach? These are three kind of ideas. One is to reduce friction. So skills data takes the friction out of labor markets and better aligns the supply, the sought skills, and demand in real time, the taught skills. So it reduces the friction for learners. They know what they're learning. They know how it applies. It adds a greater level of transparency. Second is to unlock potential. So adopting a skills-based approach helps you use skills data to unlock potential for emerging technologies like big data and artificial intelligence. If you're thinking about it in terms of skills, you can approach something like a curriculum review more intentionally and augment programs that you may already have, or ideate on programs that are going to be valuable right from the start. The third reason, big reason, why you might adopt a skills-based approach is to find talent. So if you're an employer and you're looking to hire, here in the United States, we've never had a better labor market. There are two jobs for every unemployed person in the United States. When employers are looking to procure human resource talent, skills data makes that a lot easier. Sometimes I use like the 480p versus the 4K reference. So if you've ever gone to YouTube and you've watched a video in 480p, it's like you went back in time. You're like looking at that old cathode ray tube TV and you're playing Mario and you're seeing all 16 bits of it, right? And then you hit the 4K button and all of a sudden you see this detail that you just couldn't see before. But the reality is the detail was there. You just couldn't see it because it wasn't in the right resolution. So that's what skills-based hiring and recognition does. It adds a tenfold increase in the resolution of the skills that employers are looking to see, really to find. And it also adds that same resolution to learners so they can communicate what they've learned in a way that's more tangible, actionable, evidence-based, or like Digital Promise's micro-credentialing platform, competency-based. So the skills-based approach helps us get there faster. The second thing that I recommend, and maybe, I don't know, you could get micro-credential multiverse to do this for you, is to award digital credentials. So why would you want to do that, though, if you're already awarding credentials that seem to work? What's in it for me? The WIFM, right? So awarding digital credentials immediately unlocks three key features of whatever learning system that you have, you've created, or you're looking to improve on. The first is portability. So you can give your learners control over their personal data, including information related to their skills and competencies. They earn it, they can take it away with them, and they can show it to somebody else. The second thing is independent verification. So if I want to authenticate the validity of a credential that's shared with me, do I need to go to the issuing institution? Well, we talked about data breaches, right? What if someone else holds the keys to my particular certification? It gets expensive and it's very complicated. So not only in addition to being able to verify the authenticity of the credential from the education provider's perspective, but because you're issuing a digital credential, specifically one that aligns with an open standard, that credential can be verified independently using any third-party system that recognizes that data standard. So you're not locked into any particular ecosystem for authenticating the validity, the authenticity of a particular credential. The last, and this is the biggest one, is interoperability. So adopting an interoperable digital credentialing system like an open badges or like a verifiable credentials, those records can readily be shared across networks and between systems that are recognizing those open common data standards. And, after I finished developing the first version of this presentation, I realized, if you only got my word for it, I would be doing all of you guys a disservice because there are a lot of other people working in this exact space. So one of my friends over in the UK, Yaz, he said, so I asked them, I said, what comes to mind when you think about the decentralization and democratization of education journeys? And he said, well, where education can achieve its full potential is in the decentralization of learning opportunities that can allow the most voracious learners anywhere in the world to be demonstrably identified. This is very, egalitarian. If you are actively learning and pursuing knowledge, then you should be recognized for that. And the award system that you adopt should recognize that as well. Another friend of mine from the UK, Nick, he says that the rights of students to own their learning achievements with portable verifiable credentials. So I didn't even show him the presentation. This is on the minds of people, portability and the ability to verify those credentials further increases the democratization of those learning journeys. And again, to go back, that decentralization aspect as well sort of opens new entryways to folks who may not have had access to that previously. Another individual, I know this is a mutual friend of Stephanie and I's, Andrew Fisher. So he, and by the way, they didn't just send me these paragraphs. So actually, before I read what Andrew wrote, if you want to go and download these slides from Whova, I actually added at the end of the presentation the full responses to my question. And Andrew, you know, he's an academic sort. He wrote like a whole paper. So I think that if you're keen on learning more about democratization and decentralization, like I said, I could have taken this in a bunch of directions. That's exactly what these interview questions were for. Like, what direction would you have taken this? And Andrew believes that the focus needs to change from the possession of a degree, again, as a proxy, to the possession of the pieces of the degree, which might, by the way, be a full degree. But like the credential along the way, folks, another great initiative out there, if you wanna throw a Google search on there, it shouldn't be all or nothing. I mean, if you show up every day before the last day, you still learned. So that learning needs to be recognized. So putting outcomes, the degree and the experience, the learning experiences along the way on a continuum is going to slowly move that needle towards experience over outcomes. And then lastly, Scott Meyer, you might see him on LinkedIn. He's founder of Ed3. He's the vice president of learning at Proof of Learn. He just answered in one line, democratization and decentralization of learning journeys means opportunity for all, which I love, by the way. And that was his full response. So there actually isn't a slide for him at the end. So again, you can access the full responses from some of my guest experts here in the full slide deck. You can get that on Whova. I love bonus features, by the way. When you think you're getting this much and you end up getting a lot more, I just love that. So I just wanted to thank you guys all for stopping by, my presentation here. And if you want to learn more about my work, you can head over to my website, Microcredential Multiverse, which is microcredential.xyz. Or you can reach out to me directly. I'm just opening the floodgates here. So you can email me and I would love to chat with you about micro-credentials, skills, learner wallets, rich skill descriptors, learning management systems, all that good stuff. And again, it was a real pleasure to be invited here, by Stephanie and her team at ASU. And it was a pleasure to be with all of you. So thank you. And there you go.
Yay. So, Thank you so much, Rob. We appreciate it. We're going to quickly transition over to our breakout group. So in the chat, Laura is going to put a link to a document that will guide us. But basically what we want to do is take everything that we've heard today, and we're going to stick with our jazz analogy. And why we're doing the jazz analogy is because at our live event, Ruben, who's here with us, is going to do a presentation about what we can learn from Miles Davis, who was an entrepreneurship master for jazz, what we can take from that into how we approach education. So education as jazz is our theme here. So what we're thinking about as we're going into our breakout sessions is looking at all of the components of what we've heard today. So we know we had two presentations on existing projects from our LFC friends over at Mary Lou Fulton Teachers College and from LearningPlanet. So we know that those projects already exist. We've got some the amazing ingredients from what we'll call our band members here that have given us presentations. So if we were to create an education jazz fest, in which we are asking bands to jam together, what would that look like? So we're going to create four breakout groups. We're going to do three. We're listening to what you're saying and we're watching the chat and we're creating breakout groups accordingly. So we're going to have one on AI. We're going to have one that's focusing on micro-credentials, where Robert will be. And then we have our Playful Pedagogy group. And then we have a general group, which is where I will be. So what we're asking that you do in these groups is take those how might we questions that you've been formulating throughout your time here today and apply them to how might we create something as a group, as a team, to share back out to the community, to take back to their communities of practice. So I would ask that you think about things from that perspective. We know what all the ingredients are in the recipe. How do we best put them together? And then what's the best use of our time and energy? So with that in mind, Laura, there we go. Laura is putting this all together for us. I'll be in the Choose Your Own Adventure room, and the folks that you've heard from today will be in their topic-specific rooms, and we'll come back here and share out what is the how might we question that you'd like to focus on, and we'll take that into the next session, which we have this evening, our time, and then it also into our in-person sessions, which we're holding next week. So with that, break away. We'll see you back here in about 15 minutes. Welcome back, everyone. I hope you enjoyed your time with your fellow attendees and talking about how we can frame our how might we questions. So with that in mind, I'll start, we'll start share outs, but I'll start with my Choose Your Own Adventure group. And what we chose was how might we evolve the self-actualization economy. So that meaning how we help people identify where they might have a void in skills and what skills they have that are a great match for a particular area of work, and how we identify that and how we evolve that. So with that, I will kick it over to Kelly and Nick here. How did your group do? What was your question?
So really, it wasn't really so much about how might we, it was really like, what can we, I guess, is and I'll say we named a number of critical issues around the idea of gamification and games-based learning. So just looking at some of the things that folks named, we're defining the terms and making sure those definitions are really clear for folks to understand. The ease of use, transferability of things that are learned through gamification, game-based learning to the real world. Creating customized game-based learning, the busyness of faculty, gamification for adult learners. So really, we're taking a look at that. I'm looking at the project ideas that folks listed as something that could be undertaken. And this would really just be a toolkit for teachers to implement equitable games-based learning and gamification, which is something that could address all of those things that were mentioned as critical issues and opportunities. So also like building in, what are some tools that folks could use to gamify the online classroom? Or what are some, and taking that a step further, what are some games that could be used for games-based learning, or tools to build games for games-based learning? So really great conversation. Aside from that, we were also talking about the implications of, Kelly named the implications of like Gamergate from years ago and the continued ramifications of that, and how games-based learning and gamification in the classroom can really also help address some of those things that come up. We talk a lot about like, if we want adults to behave well in online spaces and be respectful and not spew things like misogyny and racism, anti-LGBTQ rhetoric, that starts with creating an environment for kids to engage in those spaces online as kids, and modeling positive experiences and helping understand why you have to be respectful in an online space, particularly in games. So really great conversation and some really great ideas that came out of that. And thank you for the time and space.
Absolutely. Thank you, Nick. Our group that spoke about micro-credentials, Rob, how did you guys do in there?
Hello. So we took probably about half the time just getting to know each other. Like, who's in the room? Like, what is everybody working on? And that was interesting for me because it really it really illustrated the diversity of folks who are interested in micro-credentials, but also the decentralization and democratization that I talked about during my session. So I'm gonna throw in the chat sort of, you know, the question that really seemed to break through for me as I was listening to people describe the projects that they were working on and, you know, what sort of their interest, their entry point to space was. So really it was like, how might we use democratization and decentralization to address professional development? So we had someone there from a teacher's college, and training and verification of credentials. We had Dagan ask a really good question about verification and, you know, the role of ledgers, but equitably. So we had a gentleman from Palo Alto, and he really was thinking about equity first, which is right. But what I really heard was adult learners. So there was this common theme of not just all learners, but like specifically like adult learners. So there's your sentence that I kind of amalgamated from all the feedback that we got.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Rob. Our AI group. Tom, do you want to speak about the AI group?
Well, we also didn't get very far toward the how might we. We were still going through introductions and general thoughts. I don't know if anybody else in the group wants to jump up since we never oriented around a particular question. We were talking about how this is not really a new thing, but that it's really a conversation that's happening right now. And the conversation itself is part of the interest of the subject. Ruben talked about creating customized, personalized AIs that fit your needs and requirements specifically. So that could be a how might we. I talked about how I have incorporated it into my pedagogy. So, you know, how might we learn to teach with AI by our side? So.
Fantastic. Yes, I think there's a lot of points of in the Venn diagram of things overlap between what we're all talking about. And I think adult learners came up quite a bit in our conversations and how we can best utilize tools like AI to further the conversation and to further the effort and really make it into a resource for both educators and learners, and not thinking about it as a negative component of how we teach and learn, but really a step to evolve the conversation in another way.
Yeah, just remember that the most powerful chess teams in the world are humans and computers, AIs working together. And I think that's gonna migrate out to a much larger universe of activities than chess.
Yes, definitely. So with that in mind, we're gonna wrap it up. And just a heads up for you guys, we have a evening session, Mountain Standard Time, happening this afternoon, this evening. And that's really intended to for our friends on the other side of the world. But we have a different set of speakers there, and we'll be having different conversations in the breakouts based on what happens in that group. And for those of you that can, please do join us in Arizona, the 22nd through the 24th at our SkySong campus in Scottsdale. We have our kickoff party on the 22nd. And in that, we'll have a live jazz trio to, again, tie back to our jazz theme. We'll have a live poet and a food truck, and we'll be painting together a paint-by-numbers mural on oversized canvas, which will hang in the ASU Creativity Commons building when we're finished with it. So with that, I will bid you adieu, and we'll see you hopefully this evening, this afternoon, and we'll continue the conversations within our LinkedIn group and also within our social channels. So thank you guys so much, and catch you all later.